4? No. We're here. Already freaking hit the live button I love Canadian Power Slave. What a great dude. But we hit the live button as soon as he said that. So we're to prove you wrong. All right. You think it'll help the echo if you close that door a little bit? I don't know if you guys are hearing an echo or not.
Hey, there's nothing on the wall besides your certificate of shame.
That's not a certificate of shame. That's from Ichiban Moto. And that is...
Wait, no, that's... I thought that was real.
What do you mean that was... I thought that was real.
I thought that was like your plaque, like for getting 100,000 subscribers and that you just never mailed it in.
No, I never mailed in to get my 100,000 silver YouTube placard. I never did that.
Okay, I thought like this is what they sent you and then they were like, okay, now you need to send in...
No, YouTube doesn't give you a certified motorcycle builder.
Well, I don't know. I figured like the plaque was like engraved or something that they give you or something. I don't know. And that they would like...
I got a little bummed out about when they changed the plaque. When I first... I like the old ones better. And so I got it hit 100,000 in time to get the old YouTube 100K like commemorative plaque. They said if you hit 100,000, they give you a commemorative plaque. Also, when you hit 1 million, I think there's one for 2 million, and then I think there's also one for 5 million. I'm not sure. I forget how it goes like after that. Mm-hmm. But I like the old one so much better, and then I hit 100,000. It doesn't really matter to me. I'm not a big trophy guy. I could say something really cool, I guess. It's about the struggle.
I thought I was going to say, you were going to say something about your girlfriends.
No. I'd say, no, I'm a huge fan of Sisyphus. I think that the myth of Sisyphus is completely misunderstood. He tricked himself out of being in hell several times. And when he finally got sentenced to life and they finally pinned him down, well, he pushes a boulder up the hill every single day and it rolls back down and he has to do it again. This is presented to people as something horrendous, having to repeat a task over and over again. But I would say amongst everybody else in hell that Sisyphus is the only one who has a purpose.
Wait, he's in hell?
Well, everybody goes to hell in Greek mythology. There's no heaven.
There is no other spot.
Everyone's in the underworld.
What layer of hell do you think we would be on, David?
Hoping for Sisyphus.
I don't use the Greek mythology. I use Christianity, and I think you guys are going to be hanging out with me.
In the gates of hell, you get a friend pass. I'm going to be 100% honest. I don't think there's like a I vouch for this person type thing. Josh, your microphone's upside down.
Oh, can they not hear me?
Well, it's just upside down, so you're talking into the back of it. That works.
Okay. It's just not staying up.
Yeah.
None of us are in any danger of passing across the river upon with which nothing floats just yet.
I actually just learned about Dante's Inferno. They don't teach you that in school.
Really?
No.
Not in public school.
No, and definitely not as being raised Jehovah's Witness either.
Oh, okay.
So I just learned about it on Wendigoon's channel when I went to Catholic. Deep dive on it.
So I went to Catholic school. Or, Episcopalian school. Episcopalians, dude, they make the freaking... They're more Catholic than the Catholics. They love chanting, incense, lots of kneeling. The Episcopalian... I went to Episcopalian church 5 days a week.
But not in a gay way.
Actually, Episcopalians was one of the first... Very unlike the Catholics, one of the first faiths to allow queer ministers. Was Episcopalians.
Really?
Yeah, which is weird because in every other way, they're like one of the most conservative sects of Christianity. Anyway, whatever. I went to school in a very strange time of Catholic Christian-based schooling in which a lot of Christian schools were actually super progressive. So this is like the late 80s, early 90s. Anybody who went to like primary school, which is like below the sixth grade, at this time period, we'll know what I'm talking about. So I don't know if it was just the hubris of the church or what it was, but we were taught religious studies as a part of our core curriculum. And so directly after divinity class, which we took every single day, we had religious studies. And so we did Eastern religion, Greek mythology, you know, we did pagan stuff. And so we learned about every other kind of religion as well. And I took, so I took religious studies from the first grade until the sixth grade.
Wow, that's a lot.
That's insane. I didn't learn about other religions until I took a religion class in college.
It was really weird. So it's the school that I went to was incredibly in the dark ages in some ways and very progressive in some other ways. I feel very fortunate for my below sixth grade education. After that, I was like, I don't feel fortunate for anything. But first through sixth grade, I had it pretty good, man. You know, I learned a lot of really cool stuff. And people now, everything's so weird now, especially schools and stuff like that. But when I went to school, it was very, very progressive as what they taught you. The books we read too, like, they gave us required reading was Lord of the Flies. You know, this is like the second grade.
And, yeah, I haven't read Tom Sawyer, Lord of the Flies.
Which is all like, you know.
I know what Tom Sawyer is about, but also haven't read it.
They had a lot of really good books that were required reading that were
very. It's Mark Twain, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. See, I know things, but.
Mark Twain is a great American hero.
Well, I have approximate knowledge of many things. I just don't.
You should read a book about Mark Twain. Someone suggest one because I don't know one. Not one of his books, but a book about him.
Like, I don't want to read a book about Mark Twain or Ernest Hemingway. Or, like, I want to read a book about them. I don't want to read one of their books.
Ernest Hemingway is. I've just gotten very current. And we should talk about the raffle, by the way. We've got. We've got an hour and 23 minutes left. For you to win the bike of a lifetime, a Honda CBX 1000, a unicorn, a motorcycle that most people would never think they'd get to ride, let alone win for $25. I'm still in awe to Matt White and Ampere EV for making this whole thing possible. Absolutely amazing, because this is probably, you know, when I first put the bike on the channel, kind of gauge interest in it, I made a joke. I was like, I was like joking around, trolling. I don't know what it is. I'm going to make it a chopper. Just to see what people did. And so many people were like, do you know that bike's worth like $10,000? And I was like, well, actually try like 20.
If but... you can find it.
Yeah, like, yeah, if you can find one.
I made a reel about it on Instagram that's kind of going viral. I don't know. How many views do you consider viral?
If you have an audience of 10 million... and your video gets 10 million views, is that viral? I would say anything that the view count exceeds 90% of your audience would be considered viral.
Okay, so I had a video that went viral, and it was about the CBX. And, oh my gosh, Indians are loving it.
India
is like, India, I can't believe you have this bike.
Really? Motorcycle culture in India is huge. Huge.
Yeah.
It's alive and well. The Indian motorcycle culture is awesome, dude. They love bikes over there.
Yeah. I watch a lot of the videos of like reviews of different motorcycles from guys from India. They do amazing jobs. They're thorough. They get into the technical aspect of the motorcycle, their personal views as well as, you know, what the company says about them. They do a really, really good job.
They're just really into bikes over there, man. It mainly just comes from, you know, it being it's a weird thing, because there's plenty of places where bikes are required to be transportation, but not all of those places do motorcycles turn in, like, create an amazing subculture. India is one of them. Indonesia, of all places, has an amazing motorcycle subculture.
You know, there's no way of measuring it, but I wonder which country is most passionate about motorcycles. Not from the standpoint of getting from A to B for work.
Right, right.
But people who are passionate about riding.
I mean, I don't know, man. Indonesia and Thailand have some people who are just love horsepower. And it's like, dude, any place that's like, I'm going to get in trouble for this. Any place that's like Asian Alabama. You know what I mean? Like, which is like, that's Thailand, sorry. You know, Asian. Dude, they get down. That's a compliment. They fucking party there.
I know, but the connotation is horrible.
I'm just saying, they like horsepower. They like to party. They, you know, they have good times. Dude, Thailand's relationship with gasoline is phenomenal, dude. There's not one single thing that they have there that they don't make go fast as hell.
Yeah.
It could be a boat. It could be a scooter. It could be a motorcycle. It could be a quad. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It's souped up, and it's got anodized metal on it. And they're and they're hauling ass in it.
These guys love purple.
It doesn't matter. So I follow a few Thai customization places. Not only do they do all that I just said, but like all the guys who have construction equipment, they customize their
construction
equipment. They're like killdozer. Yeah. Oh, dude, if they have like a backhoe, it's covered, like all the hydraulic lines are chrome. And it's got, you know, it's, everything's anodized or chromed or polished, and it's got exhaust on it. And it's like their backhoe that they use for work. Those guys get down.
Yeah. Like this video, if you like the killdozer.
The works, I always see you, man. Yeah, India culture, though, is awesome, too. I think that India would win from sheer numbers of people who are into motorcycles. There's just so many. The population is so huge that so many people are into bikes there.
Yeah. The passion that I'm talking about is not quantifiable. I'm talking about your gut feelings about motorcycle when you wake up in the morning. Like when we met in California and I woke up and went on a 45-minute ride before driving 800 miles. Yeah. I was like pretty sick. And that's I didn't even realize it.
That's a universal thing right there. That whole like I'm going to, you know, riding just to ride.
I'm going
like
to go ride my bike.
Yeah. Yeah, it's freaking awesome. Everybody say what's up to Cindy in the chat. So, speaking of passion, Honda CBX 1000, the sound, the fury. I was about to start talking about, I've been really like into the whole feud between Faulkner and Hemingway recently. But just these two sides of manly prose of Hemingway and the flowery $10 words of Faulkner. So who you got in the chat? Are you a Faulkner or a Hemingway guy? I think you know who I got in my corner. It's Papa.
I like cats.
Yeah, I like cats. It's Papa, dude. But, you know, I do love who you,
love
you can't
when
deny
you call me Big
Faulkner.
Papa.
Anyway, I think Papa would write a CBX 1000 if they were around before he died. I still can't believe we're giving this bike away, man. It's insane, and it's completely because of a place called Ampere EV. Can you share that link, Shay? Or I guess I can.
What?
The Ampere EV. Yeah, I'll share
it. I do not have it. But I can share the raffle link as you, because that's what I'm logged in on my iPad as. I just realized.
So Ampere EV, it's a cool company, man. I guess some people are going to talk crap about it because they convert gasoline cars into electric cars, but for enthusiasts. So they don't, I think they will do the conversion, but they just sell like the kit for the enthusiast. So think about it like they're like the S&S of electric motors.
Yeah.
You know, so it's like if you have a car, maybe like for me, if I think about like, okay, what would I want to convert? So basically you would think anything that you would LS swap. So for me, it's like my dream cars that have bad engines, Jaguar XJ, Porsche 928, things that I'm like, oh, these are cars I absolutely love who have traditionally very unreliable, very underpowered engines. So that's what they do. So the one, they're big, and I'm going to share this one. One of the ones they did, which this car had such a boring engine, was the DeLorean. And so
54 horsepower, that's all it had.
Yeah, the DeLorean was just, it was one of the coolest looking cars of all time, still today. And it just, the engine, it was a Volvo engine. It was just a freaking boat anchor in that thing. I've driven a DeLorean.
Yeah.
They're slow. They drive like crap. This one is probably the fastest DeLorean in the world.
Yeah, more than likely.
It's a dual motor electric DeLorean, and it freaking hauls ass, which I think is like a DeLorean makes such a perfect EV swap vehicle.
Mm-hmm.
Cars where like their original engines are just like, who cares? Another ones I think that are people will hate me for this one, but Volkswagens, even though I find the Volkswagen engine to be very interesting, it's like, I mean, it's still just a VW engine.
I feel like if I was born 10 or 20 years earlier, I'd be driving a Volkswagen Bug.
You mean 40 years earlier.
Or in Mexico.
Yeah. Yeah, they're old.
I don't think they've made like an actual Beatle since like 79 was the last Super Beatle, maybe. Yeah. Or did they go into the 80s, the last one in America?
Super Beatle?
Super Beatle was the last
That's a very funny name.
Yeah, they were big. They made the flat four engine, though, and also as a flat six in the van as the Westfalia for a long time afterwards, though. That's what Eric has. He has a fuel-injected, air-cooled Westfalia. That is just the thing is such a treat to drive. It's very fun to drive. It's a stick shift, and it's.
Did he restore it? Did he buy it like that?
No, that has been in his family since it was new.
Okay.
So he did. I guess
family
he did
heirloom.
It's an heirloom. Yeah. His parents bought it brand new in 1982.
That's very cool.
And wow. So he inherited it and he restored it.
That's what we had growing up.
Westfalia.
It wasn't a Westfalia, but it was the VW bus. I still remember going to. There's a camp called Park Safari, and they said no animals. But we were camping. We had our St. Bernard stuck in the back, and the baboons ripped every piece off of that car that they could get their hands on. They ripped off the antenna, the wipers, the door handles, everything trying to get into that car because we snuck a St. Bernard in.
Oh, man. Yeah, Classic Mini would be a great EV swap. Tri Triple Kylie in the chat has a, I think she has a like a GSXR motor or something in her Mini, or maybe she just has a Mini motor that's souped up. Tri Triple Kylie has like 10 cars. She has a rotisserie. Mm-hmm. I've seen it on her Instagram when she used to make YouTube videos. A rotisserie is how you completely restore a car body. So
I thought it was like a chicken rolling on a
large scale. So you put the car body on that so you can flip it over and turn it around so you can really actually get rid of all the rust. So it's a real restoration, not what I do. It's an actual restoration.
That's really cool.
At least I think she has a rotisserie. I believe I've seen it. Or maybe she was borrowing somebody else's or something. It's a huge thing. Like my dream garage would have a rotisserie. Mm-hmm. Like, and you literally like, so you take the body off the frame so you can just like get at every single part of it.
Get a Costco chicken every day. Yeah. That's the dream, man. Endless
anyway,
Costco chicken.
Matt from Ampere EV is the one who donated the CBX. And that was his dream bike. And he donated it to Forgotten Angels. I think that was pretty freaking cool, man. If you're at the camp out, you saw him. He gave a speech.
Move that one farther back. And then it'll be more even and won't droop down.
Oh, it had an R1 engine in it. So, yeah, Matt was at the camp out. He gave a speech. He donated it. And originally, we were going to buy it from him, which would have been, and he wasn't asking much for it. But I had said, like, okay, we'll buy it from you. And then he came to the camp out. Matt from Ampere. Matt owns Ampere EV, EV, I should say. And he's a, you know, he's a gearhead. So he has lots of fast toys and plenty of them have gasoline engines. He's huge into gasoline engines as well. He just also likes electric. If it goes fast, he likes it. So, we were originally going to buy it from him at a pretty discounted price for what the motorcycle is. And, I was like, yeah, come to the camp out, just check it out, blah, blah, blah. You know, just see how everyone's doing and what's going on. And he actually took the time out, even though he was taking his, I think his niece and a group of her friends to the beach or something like that. Like he had something else mm-hmm. to do, but he did. He stopped by and I asked him to make a speech. He's a good public speaker. So he got up and he made a very passionate speech because he came from nothing. He's a self-made man. You know, when he was in his 20s, if anyone out there is in their mid-20s, when Matt, who now owns several companies and does as he pleases, when he was 25, he was valeting cars at West Shore Plaza. So you can make it too. So that's not that long ago. He's in his 50s. You know, he's not 60. He's in his 50s. So that's, you know, 20 years later, he's where he's at now.
And you consider that not that long ago?
So just to finish that off, he gave the speech and... He then, after he left, he called me on the phone. He goes, you know, I can't actually charge you for that now after I just met everybody. And I'm like, that's not what I was angling for.
Yeah.
And he goes like, yeah, no, just, you can just have it and give it away. So this is a true 100%, not a single dollar was spent on this bike. A true 100%. Every single penny is going to Forgotten Angels, which I think is pretty cool. So If you buy $25, no percentage of that $25 is going to go to anything but Forgotten Angels, not even the cost of buying a motorcycle. So, no, I don't think 20 years is a long time. Not anymore.
No.
So, somebody left a comment. I'm going to make an Instagram post about this later. I put it in my videos coming out tomorrow. Somebody made a comment on a post that I made, and they said, I just realized that I was born 9 days after you started your YouTube channel. That's pretty cool.
That is actually pretty cool.
And I go, oh, okay. I was like, let me go see when I started my YouTube channel.
Yeah, because of the
date. Because I'm like, what are you, 12?
Yeah, I was going to say 12 or 11 or 12, right?
16, though.
So, no. I took a screen cap of it because now I just forgot.
18 now.
Because I've always said, I think in that same video, I was like, oh, I've been doing YouTube for like 12 years.
Yeah, but you've been saying 12 years for like 5 years.
I know, I did. So I started my YouTube channel in, or it has the exact date, August 20th, 2006. So no, I don't think 20 years is a long time.
Dude, that's 18 years.
That's 18 years ago, man.
That's amazing.
Or it's Sisyphus, because everyone's like, oh, you have such a huge channel. I'm like, I've been doing this for 18 freaking years, man. People were like, I wish I could have the growth that you had. I'm like, if you divide up 283,000 subscribers over 18 years, it's not that much. I promise you. This is a war of attrition here. But thank you to everybody who is here. And there are some people who have been here for the whole time. So yeah, Jerry, technically 17 years ago. Technically 17. Anyway, it's not as old. The bike's 41 years old, but it rides like it's brand new. Because Matt took excellent care of it. That's why I can't have it.
Yeah, it looks like a bike that can be like in a museum.
Almost. And that's
which is why I saw people in the comments asking if I've ridden it. The answer is no, and I will not, because it looks like it should be in a museum.
It's it is almost that quality. So what I would say is that, and there's like words for it, how you describe the quality, but it's basically as good as you would want a rider to be. If it was any nicer, you'd be like, I don't want to ride it.
Well, with my girl brain, I say nay.
The paint is amazing.
It's too nice.
Yeah. The paint's amazing. The engine, there's no flaking on the engine. There's no, the powder coat's not flaking off. It's a couple little chips on like the powder coat on the controls and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, even though it's a CBX and it's a unicorn bike, it's got the same hand controls as like a GL500, because it's still a Honda, man. Honda, yeah. Just like, they took the Lee Iacocca approach. They just everything got shared, dude. There was no motorcycle that had a different kill switch.
Not to show your age.
You got the same kill switch on a CB125 as you got on a CBX1000. Like, they're just the exact same controls. So that's some people remember Lee Iacocca, who I think it was a great inspiration. His book is amazing. If you haven't read Lee Iacocca's book, it's really inspirational, especially if you're trying to become an entrepreneur and trying to make your own way in the world. It's a very, very inspirational book. It just teaches you how to deal with people and stuff like that. I know you've read it.
Yeah. I like, what's it? His famous saying, I like the brand so much, I bought the business or bought the company.
Yeah. Anyway, so Lee, and especially if you're a Ford guy, or I guess also a Chrysler guy, but I feel like what he did for Ford was way cooler than he did for Chrysler, because Ford was making some cool cars when Iacocca was there, and then Chrysler got the K car. Those are pretty lame, dude.
Yeah, but he also turned that company like literally around at a 180.
Anyway. Huge thanks to everybody who's bought a raffle ticket, and some people have bought thousands of raffle tickets. Or thousands of dollars, not thousands.
That's a lot of raffle tickets.
Thousands,
Josh,
of dollars in raffle tickets. I always feel bad because I'm just like, whenever I see somebody who's bought like thousands of dollars of raffle tickets, I'm like, I hope you win, but I also have no control. We've had people who've won, like, I think the person who won once, who's bought the most amount of raffle tickets, probably was Flip.
Oh yeah, Flip.
Flip, yeah, sense. Flip and the Demo.
Like
Macon, thank you, man. Keep you the Viking Creative Studios donated $20.
I can't believe that.
Even after I talked all that crap about TikTok Vikings basically being juggalos.
Oh my god, they are though.
Yeah, they're like European juggalos. It's very funny.
Oh my gosh. So there's also like
but we love juggalos. It's a
no, you know. I stan. And also like
thank you.
Everyone's using juggalo audio on TikTok now. As because I guess clowns are popular now. It's like a thing girls do. They dress up in clown makeup.
You guys want to hear the worst ASMR for a recovering alcoholic? That right there, dude. That's literally like, it's like a cartoon.
Is that what
sound.
Like the torch sound is to me?
Yeah, yeah. It's the dab sound. Yeah, the torch sound where you're just like, ooh, time to drink. Time to smoke. Oh, Blue Healer, my man. No, K-Car turbos are very cool. So the Daytona Turbo is a very cool car. What's very cool about 80s turbo cars is that the engineers who were designing these cars, these are the same guys who designed like cars, engines in the 1950s. So the 1980s when they were designing these cars, or really it would have been in like the late 1970s when the actual designs got done before they rolled out into actual production. These guys were old, man. They weren't new. These guys were like a step removed. They were new engineers when like the Model T was coming out. Like these guys were like, they were designing flatheads. And all of a sudden the late 70s comes around. They're like, all right, make a turbo car. And so what was really cool about it is they had no idea what to expect. Because they'd never dealt with this technology before. So they overbuilt the bottom ends for turbo forced induction. So you take a regular engine, it just forces more air into it, right? This is very simplified. So what that does is it puts stress on the bottom end. So you have the piston rod that's connected to the crank. And when it goes down, that's where all the force gets put on it. And so that's what will give out over if you really overboost a car, is as it goes down so hard from all this forced induction that you blow things apart. And so they knew that because that's what you have to do is you do have to build a bottom end if you're going to do forced induction on a car. And so they built these bottom ends so stout that they built cars that were making like 150 horsepower that had bottom ends that could handle like 900 horsepower, which is insane. So you could take these cars and just boost them to the moon and they'd take it. They're so good that right now the EcoBoost motor, the four-cylinder EcoBoost motor, uses not the same because now it's an aluminum block instead of an iron block, and they've obviously made some changes, but it uses the same design as the original 2.3-liter turbocharged four-cylinder that was in SVO Mustangs and Escorts in the 80s because the design was just freaking amazing. It was good. It was amazing. They overbuilt it. The same one that made like 200 horsepower back in the day. They're like, yeah, I can make like 450 horsepower now. Like, no problem. Yeah, pull it out of the file. Put it in the car. It's fine. It's just a cool, if you're into the history of engineering and automotive and motorcycle stuff. It's a very, the late 70s and 80s was a very, very cool, pivotal time. Passing of the torch. Where like a lot of new engineers were coming in, a lot of old school guys were going out, and you just had this weird mix of like all this new technology coming out and trying to adapt old tech into new tech. So it's, I think, in my opinion, the most interesting time in engineering history. Not design history, but engineering, yeah. Like motor engineering history. It was the late 70s and 80s.
I was listening to Joe Rogan the other day, and he said that they stopped making cool cars, like, designing, because everyone stopped taking LSD, and cars were really cool because everyone was taking LSD, and that's why the designs were really awesome.
Yeah. I mean, the homogeny of cars was something that started in the 90s, and so you had a lot of leftover in the design area. But, you know, in the 1950s, you look at, like, even architecture, like Googie architecture, and this is coming off the back of, Art Deco, which Art Deco is so, like, bold and big. And then you got into the whole Rocket Age and Googie stuff, where you're like, oh, this, like, make everything look like a spaceship.
Yeah.
goes, you know, 1950s, it was the space race. It's a cool. Yeah, they were like, make it look like a spaceship.
That was the age where they were like, put more buttons in a car.
That was the
80s.
So the 80s was buttons. Because they were like, more buttons. Future tech was the 80s with buttons. It was on the outside of the vehicle. It was like, make it look like a rocket ship in the 50s and 60s. And then going into the 60s and 70s, it was make it low. It was a big, like, long and low was a big thing. And cars just got oversized, but definitely homogenized. And styling was still, to a certain degree, homogenized in the 80s. But then the inside tech became way more important. So it was like computers and buttons and dials and knobs. Like, everything had to have, like, 1,000 buttons and knobs and dials.
Something that Dr. Seuss designed. Yeah. And Joe Rogan, you know, the way he talks about car design, it's like these guys took LSD, took a cocktail napkin, doodled something on it, and then sent it to the designer.
That's not how engineering works.
No, I know, but when you listen to Joe Rogan, he thinks it's that, you know, he oversimplifies it.
So. Yeah, and which I love. We're Brogans around here.
Yeah,
I love Joe
we
Rogan.
Stand.
I like, not love.
Yeah. No, we. Whenever there's something comes up, oh, we're no, like, let's wait and see what Joe Rogan says.
Yeah, like, we stand.
But when it comes to that sort of stuff, he is an enthusiast. He's a huge
car
enthusiast.
Yeah, yeah. Imagine what his garage is like. Oh, my God.
Pretty cool, I would imagine. I mean, I don't know. He got, like, a lot of the cars.
He's probably into muscle cars,
whenever you talk about
right?
cars, it's always, like, very, like, exactly what you'd expect.
Muscle
he's like,
cars.
What do you have, a Chevelle? I'm like...
Also, how much you know, time do you think Joe really drives? You know, he's flying from here to there, and
true,
you know.
Man.
Actually, I never see him on anyone else's podcast. Everybody always goes to him.
Well, you know, I mean, when
if I was right. If I had his clout, nobody would be on my. You know, I wouldn't be going to anybody.
Share the link.
Yeah, I've been sharing the link. Yeah, I've never seen Joe Rogan on anyone else's podcast, which I understand he's got the biggest podcast, like, what in the world?
Well, and it looks funny, you know, like the other day I saw Seth Meyers on Jimmy Kimmel, and I'm like, you know, you just lowered yourself, you know, to go on Jimmy Kimmel. Now Jimmy Kimmel is interviewing you. I don't know, he seemed like kind of weird about it, but you know, it is what it is.
Which celebrity garage would you like to see the most, not including Leno? Keanu Reeves.
No, actually, it would be Billy Joel.
Billy Joel?
Billy Joel has an incredible garage.
That's the guy from Green Day, right?
No, Billy Joel, the singer?
Yeah, from Green Day.
No, Billy Joel is Billy Joel.
Yeah, Piano from Green
Man.
Day.
What? You're fucking with me now. from Green Day. Hey, I want to ask everybody, because I'm going to be in Ohio on May the 4th at a poker run. How many people here that are online right now are in Ohio?
We have a lot of Ohio.
I know, there's
a
ton.
We've got a lot of Ohio.
Yeah, in fact, Jess, her two wheels is going to come. Jersey is going to be there. Shep is going to ride from Tampa to, it's St. Clairsville, in Ohio for a poker run. It's being hosted by a gentleman named Kyle Martin. I think maybe Shay or Josh can post it later on so people can learn a little bit more about that. But we're going to be up there on the 3rd, and then we'll stay until the 4th, and we'll ride back probably on the 5th. So, May J.
Nobody liked my joke. I love that. Drop in the comments below if you prefer your vehicles with or without buttons. Like, do you like buttons in your vehicles, or are you like, I want no buttons? Because I prefer my motorcycles with buttons,
and
my cars without buttons. Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we're talking about Green Day.
Oh, boring.
And yeah, Billy Joel.
Billy Joel, dude. Billy Joel loves motorcycles.
No, but Billy Joel is the front man for Green Day.
Really? The piano man guy?
Yeah, he's like, I don't want to be American idiot. Yeah, something. Billy Joel?
Yeah. No, I remember Green Day super well.
Somebody asked what would be like the celebrity garage that you would want to see the most. Who But besides Jay Leno.
Besides Jay Leno. Because that's such an obvious.
Yeah, you're not
it's
allowed
almost
to.
Like a museum.
Like, you're not allowed to say Jay Leno.
Well, yeah, because it wouldn't be like who has the most stuff. It would be like...
Who has the coolest stuff.
Who has the coolest stuff, but also like who am I most interested to see what their taste is like. Mm-hmm. So I think it would be something along the lines of like, oh, this is a celebrity that I like feel like I identify with mm-hmm. or that I like maybe put on a pedestal, which I know is a bad idea.
Yeah.
But you still have them. You know?
Yeah.
Apparently Schwarzenegger has a pretty significant garage of vehicles.
Yeah, he seems like a lot of immigrants are always like, especially older immigrants, are always, who've made it big, they're car guys.
Yeah.
Stallone, they're like, I'm going to come to America, I'm going to have some fucking cars, dude.
That's my uncle.
Yeah, yeah. Because, I mean, that's the American, part of the American dream, the 1950s, when the car ownership, you
really?
Know. Well, car ownership was not... It started with the Model T, like opening it up to the common person, but car ownership along with home ownership became a thing in the 40s and 50s, where that wasn't like a normal thing, you know, not everybody had a car. And then in the 1950s, like it was a thing where like everybody had a car. That's when all of our roads got built.
Mm-hmm.
That's when, because the American tourism and the road trip, that became a thing. And you're like, hey, you travel America by car. Route 66, you know, and so all of our roads in America, not all of our roads, obviously, but a vast majority of the roads that you, me, and David have ridden our motorcycles on, those were built in the 1950s.
Yes, you told me that when we were riding, doing one of our cross-country trips, and it kind of changed my perspective of roads, just like me thinking about us going through those like big stretches of desert, and then you're going through like a mountain for like 5 seconds, but then you're back in the desert for like another 100 miles.
There's dudes out there freaking digging
like,
that out of the earth,
dude. Mm. They just like trucked through the desert for 100 miles with some dynamite just to blow up this one section and keep going.
Yeah. Just like a bunch of dudes out there in the heat, just freaking slapping asphalt on the ground, blowing stuff up.
Pretty insane. Yeah. And like looking up photos of how stuff was built back then is pretty crazy.
Did you see some of the, of how Pacific Coast Highway was built and a lot of the
nuts,
bridges?
Dude. Look up some pictures.
It's like it's almost as bad as the Hoover Dam and all the Chinese and Japanese that were killed trying to build that. Yeah,
building that thing, man, it's wild.
That's actually a conspiracy theory. No one actually died building the Hoover Dam.
They have a memorial for it, though.
Oh wait, it's this conspiracy that there's people in the concrete.
Oh, that's
true. No,
they would have fished them out because it would compromise the concrete.
Yeah,
because there'd be a pot because your
there'd
body
be a
would
void.
Rot.
Yeah, yeah.
Well,
so there'd
or
be a
would
void
it?
In it.
It would rot in the concrete.
Concrete is porous. I imagine over time it would. Yeah. I think that it would take a lot longer.
Yeah.
I'd rather not find out.
So what celebrity garage do you want to see?
Let's just piss off Joe Pesci.
Yeah. I don't know, man. I'm still trying to think of whose garage I'd want to see. I mean, Tom Segura comes to mind because he doesn't show his cars.
Yeah, but you know he's got them.
I'm very interested to know what he has because he's like a late bloomer car guy. Because I don't think he was a car guy before he had money. And so those are two very different people. Like, I don't have money, but I'm a vehicle.
Yeah, there's a couple
I'm
good...
I'm a vehicle guy.
There's a couple of good suggestions on here. Marilyn Manson.
Oh, I wonder if he like... I've heard that.
He's a car dude, for sure. And then somebody said Gabriel Iglesias has a huge VW collection, to which
he's from Mexico, so it makes tracks. And that's not an insult. Dude.
Yeah, no, but
they made VW culture is huge in Mexico,
and of course Keanu Reeves.
I feel like I know what Keanu Reeves has.
Of course, because he's on every damn show showing it to everybody.
Tom Segura doesn't show what he has, but I know that he's a nouveau car guy.
Yeah,
anyone
who doesn't show what they have, I'm sure they've got like
stuff,
you've got some expensive.
I've seen some pictures.
Shit.
He's got like a Porsche GTR. Like he's got super
you know,
high-end
okay,
Euro
you know,
cars.
You want to know who mine is? Total generation gap here too. Yeah. Tyler, the Creator.
Oh, yeah, dude. He's way
He loves cars.
Yeah.
He put a bike rack on a Rolls Royce.
I'm into it. Viking Creative Studio says we have a $10,000 moto vlog rig models and cold beer. How can we get you guys up to...
Rhode Island?
Oh, Rhode Island? I'll go to Rhode Island, dude.
I'd go to Rhode Island. It's
I love
really...
shellfish.
Isn't Rhode Island either, the right? State that's like an super island? Small?
Is it an actual island?
I don't think it's an island.
It's in the fucking name.
Yeah, but like.
I mean, it's
have,
in the name.
Have you ever seen it?
Have you ever seen Rhode Island? Only on Family Guy.
Is it an island?
I don't know. I've seen it on Family Guy, and then that's also where Sam Hyde lives.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, so like every time we're big Sam Hyde fans, sorry. We're definitely based and red-pilled. We listen to Perfect Guy Life.
No, dude, I took both pills, and now I'm going to Rhode Island.
So whenever he does stuff like outside, I'll see like Rhode Island.
Not an island.
It's not an island, but
that's
it's
what Drew says, okay. And I trust Drew. So.
We have to trust Drew. He used to walk by our open garage all the time, and he never.
I know,
came
right? Oh, Nicolas Cage. That's a good garage. I bet he has really. I want to see his closet.
He's a collector. He collects a lot of
Williams
stuff.
Williams has a big car collection.
Yeah.
So there's a really specific. And this like falls into a category that is kind of almost like lost cars. And so there was a big custom car scene in like the 70s and very early 80s with Cadillacs. It was very much a very urban thing, Reed Black, but it doesn't matter. It's an amazing custom car scene. And so it was kind of like, I would say like the precursor to what you would see people doing with Dunks now. And like the precursor to like the, you know, the scene in Texas, like the, what do they call them? Like tipping on 4.4s, rolling on Vogues. I forget what they call the actual cars. It's not Dunks. Dunks is a South thing. And then like Texas, they do like the big long spoked wheels that come out and stuff like that. Anyway, so a big precursor to that was in the 70s. I don't know what they're called, but there's a huge custom Cadillac scene where they would just completely change the body of these things. And so many of them just got lost to time. And every once in a while, there was one on Facebook Marketplace for like $45,000 the other day. And I was just like, God, I wanted, if I had, so that's what my garage would look like. And I also am like, I hope that's what Cat Williams' garage looks like. That he has like some very weird niche builder. Somebody help me in the chat. I know somebody out there knows the like what this style of cars was called.
I know Shaq has a big collection of cars and motorcycles too.
Can we get a revamp of
so Cadillacs with like chandeliers hanging on the outside and stuff?
It would be really cool if we got like a revamp of the MTV show Pimp My Ride, but instead of trapping poor people into it, we just did celebrities. Like, could you imagine doing like MTV but just celebrity Pimp My Rides? They're like, so it's like, yo, we heard you like to relax, so we put a koi pond in your trunk type stuff, you know? Like,
yeah, that's what Michael Winslow was talking to me about wanting to get involved. And he's going to be
doing MTV's Pimp My Ride?
Not Pimp My Rides, but just refurbishing and restoring cars. And then
I mean, I really couldn't,
doing the voice. I don't know why he got into it, but he's already done a couple cars.
Mm-hmm. I'm trying to see if I can find that Cadillac on Facebook Marketplace. There's one that's got pushed to me. Oh, there it is.
What's up, Nine Mills?
So you look at that, you're like, oh, I recognize like that style.
Yeah.
I've never seen one in person. I've always just seen them in like movies and TV shows and stuff like that. But for a while, that was a whole ass style of car. Yeah. I was doing this really. It kind of went along with what they called Coney Island bikes, which was another big Hispanic and Black thing back in the day. And that's when it was like a dresser thing in the 70s. Where you had the chopper scene and then you had the dresser scene where they just like would just make these incredible wrought, not iron, but like wrought mild steel and then chrome, like filigree with all these lights on it and stuff like that. You would love Coney Island bikes.
No, someone just said in the comment, they just go Snake Plissken.
Anyway, so you guys know what I'm talking about. I'm going to share the link for this in the chat. So if somebody has $35,000 and is near Wesley Chapel, Florida, and they want to make me happy, they could buy this for me. you know, no big deal. Seriously, no big deal.
Seriously.
But you know, I mean, got an extra 35 fucking big ones lying around.
And if you guys ever see something cool on Facebook Marketplace, you can always just email it.
I do. I get a lot of emails of Facebook Marketplace finds, and some of them I've bought. So please continue to email. Always
send us Facebook Marketplace stuff, regardless of where you live, because we travel. Oh my God, somebody's name is Snake Plissken, and they just go, yo. Like, you called?
We have an hour left.
Oh my God, this is very meta.
Yeah, Cholo bikes, dude. Big. And so the Cholo bike thing is very, like, I think came out of the Coney Island bike thing. You can type in Coney Island motorcycle or Coney Island custom.
I just want to see motorcycle. A hot dog bike.
I shared the Facebook link, man. You guys can see it. We're still in a beta version of our new setup at the new place. So we don't have the ability to share anything on screen right now.
What do you guys think about sitting at a table instead of sitting at the desk, though? Because I prefer this personally, but it's not about what I like.
I think that with a couple more camera angles, we'll be set.
Yeah. I just only set up this one for today.
My biggest thing when I'm talking to people who are watching is I want to be able to look at them when I'm talking to them.
Same.
And so it's like, and I'll forget to look at the camera because I'm also in the room with everybody else. So that's my biggest thing because I've got the chat up in front of me. I'm seeing what people are saying. I just don't respond to everything. Because if I responded to everything that everybody said, and please say stuff because I see it, but if I responded to everything that everybody said, the entire video would be just be me responding to what everybody said, which would be like, well, after you ask me a question, then you'd be like, well, I don't want to listen to this, would answer 100 other questions.
Yeah, this would literally just be an ask me anything chat. Yeah,
which we do sometimes. But today we're talking about the bike of a lifetime, a super rare Honda CBX 1000. The CBX 1000 was the brainchild of a guy, and his name was Ichiro. He had a really, I think his first name was Akira, which I was just like, yo, they really name people Akira? I thought that was just the anime. But no, his name was apparently it's like a common Japanese name. It's like John. Like, it's a pretty common Japanese name, Akira. I am who I am, okay? I admit it. I'm not... no, they don't actually... I'd be like if an American movie came out.
Yeah.
And they're just like, all black people are named Moses.
Okay, so something.
I don't know.
Oh, shut up, first of all. Someone says that they don't like our bare wall. The wall's not bare.
It's pretty bare.
YouTube certified motorcycle builder.
Yeah, that's from...
Not bare.
From Ichiban Moto. Not everybody has those, okay? That's mm-hmm. pretty rare. Not everybody's got one of those. It's you gotta kind of be a big deal to get that. I've had that piece of paper that he printed out off his printer for 10 years.
I saved that because I thought that was the only way that you could get your YouTube plaque was mail that in or something. That's why I've trucked it around since Brapstar Garage, saving it in our files.
Oh, the guy who made that, remember that little lighter leash I showed you with the leather one? He's in the chat.
Oh, Raven King. That's so cool.
Nice meeting you too, bud. So anyway, the guy's like, Iramichi
Jerry!
The low budget blockhead setup. That's our entire channel, man.
Yeah, we're low budget blockhead.
We're low budget blockhead. Curses blockhead. So the Akira Iramajiri. I know. It's Akira Iramajiri. And so he was the lead engineer in Honda's race team and their multi-cylinder project. So he did work on cars, but he also worked on motorcycles. So he was responsible for the Honda 250cc inline six, which just destroyed the MotoGP scene in the 60s and 70s. And so he was also in charge of the Goldwing team. Akira Iramajiri headed that up. And so I forget what the original concept for the Goldwing was called, but he's the one who designed that engine. And the original Goldwing, if you guys didn't know, was designed as a sport bike to replace the CB750 as a bigger multi-cylinder motorcycle. And then it just turned into a touring bike because it was better for that. But they originally designed it as a flat six, not a flat four. And then, which was funny because when they went to the GL1500, they actually pulled the old flat six, because they still have it, they, you know, pulled it out of the archives and pulled the one that they made because they made it. And they basically based the GL1500 around it. Very cool. And so Akira Irimajiri also designed the CBX1000. And then after that, he left Honda in the 90s and went on to become the president of Sega and headed up the Dreamcast project.
Wow.
Which he should have stuck with Hondas because the Dreamcast was a total stinker, dude. Oh, it's a Dreamcast, dude. It was a bomb, dude. It was like the worst thing that ever happened
to Sega.
I was going
to say, he's like the one who got away. And he should have stayed with Honda.
Yeah, dude. He was the president of Sega, and he brought us the Dreamcast, which basically turned Sega from a console company into a company that just makes Sonic games.
Yeah.
So, but millions and millions of dollars worth of them.
Oh, dude, the Dreamcast was a big-time flop. But, hey, you know, none of his bikes were. All of his bikes were amazing, dude. He should have stuck with engines. He should have stuck as an engineer. Anyway, so he designed the Honda CBX, so thank Akira Irimajiri for this. It also never really took off, much like the Dreamcast. Which had to have been a bummer at the time because, you know, putting an inline six engine in a motorcycle, previous, it was done also by Kawasaki with the KZ1300, but previously it had only been done either in race motorcycles, but then there was also Benelli, which was an Italian manufacturer.
Didn't BMW do it also?
No, BMW did it later.
Okay.
So BMW is currently the only inline six engine. And what they did was they just miniaturized the M3 motor, which is now the M2. So they took their inline six that they put in their performance vehicles and they just made it smaller.
Is that the most?
They stuck it in a bike.
In line?
The six? Most in line? There are straight eights. That's a thing. But they were never put in bikes. It was a car thing. There's also V16s, which would be more in a line. They're just on two sides.
Yeah.
Could you imagine how wide we could make one bike?
What's his name? The guy who made all those. So he made V12 bikes. So this was, his name has escaped me. He was an English engineer.
Didn't he use the format of the Jaguar, the XK8 or
so
the XJ?
He, took two KZ1300 engines and made a V12 and put it in a motorcycle. Okay. It looks like a stock engine. Someone's going to say it down there. His name just ran right out of my head. And what was his name? He has a YouTube channel that he posts on. He's still in action right now. What is his name? Alan Milliard. Yeah, Alan Milliard. When it comes to motorcycles, the English hero. He put a Viper engine in a bike, which doesn't sound that crazy. Oh, yeah, Boss Hosses and stuff like that. But yeah. Alan Milliard's V10 Viper engine in a motorcycle, it wasn't just to like stuff a Viper engine in a motorcycle, which not to say anybody could do it, but anybody who has a welder and a decent engineering background could figure it out, right? He did it. And the cool thing about it was that he made it street legal.
Yeah.
Like it was able to pass what they call the MOT in England. So he took, that was like the cool thing behind it. Like he just took it in and he was like, yeah, he got like the sticker where it's like, yeah, you could just drive this around now. Yeah. That was a very cool thing about the V10. I feel like the V10, the Viper engined motorcycle from Alan Milliard is a very misunderstood bike because it wasn't just about stuffing a ridiculous engine in a motorcycle. It was about making it a rideable street legal motorcycle.
I think it takes more than just a welder and an engineering degree to do what Alan Milliard does.
Well, a welder and a little bit of engineering background gives you like the Boss Hoss.
Yeah.
Which is no shade or aspersions.
Yeah.
But a Boss Hoss ain't no freaking Alan Milliard creation.
No.
Okay.
It's Frankenstein.
Yeah. If you've ever been in front of one, you know what I'm talking about. I mean, I wouldn't kick one out of bed, but you know. I'll be right back. Don't talk about anything cool on the...
Like tomahawks?
God damn.
That's what somebody said in the comment. They just go tomahawk.
Yeah, Milliard is a magician. He really is. He does stuff that other people not can't do, but don't even have the brain power to come up with those ideas. He's insane. Mm-hmm.
That's how I feel about the guy who did the killdozer.
Yeah.
Like, how'd you think of that? Amazing. Genius.
Now, Shelby put me onto him a few years ago, and I've watched so many of his videos. And
the killdozer guy?
No, Alan Milliard. Oh, okay. Yeah. And he just sit there in awe of what he's able to do.
I have never heard of him until now, but that's like a lot of
you probably
car motorcycle stuff.
That... No, you probably have. You just probably didn't know that mm-hmm. his stuff was, it was Alan Milliard, because he's so popular mm-hmm. even here in America with the stuff that he's able to do that, I mean, honestly, I and with your knowledge of motorcycles, more than likely you just didn't know it was him.
Yeah, but I only really got into motorcycles a few years ago, even mm-hmm. though I've been riding for 10 years.
Mm-hmm.
Besides that, I was just riding one's transportation, like the way anyone treats their car. Like, I didn't ride motorcycles because I was like, yeah, motorcycle culture. I'm super into building motorcycles and knowing about them. I was just like, I need something that my insurance is really cheap.
When did it click? Because you're definitely not just a, you know, A to B person anymore. When did it click where you started to be really passionate about it?
Definitely when I made a YouTube channel and mm-hmm. like built my own community of people who were interested in riding motorcycles, because even before that, I didn't understand why somebody would want to ride a motorcycle with
mm-hmm.
me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, people would be like, let's go for a ride. I'm like, fucking why? Like, what the fuck would you do that? Like, that's like saying, you want to go for a drive? I'm like, no.
Yeah.
Do literally anything else with my time than sit.
And now you've been across country like twice.
Yeah, so now my attitude about motorcycles has just really changed, because I don't look at it as transportation anymore. Because yeah. that's what it was to me before. Lifestyle, you know? It wasn't anything welcome about culture. Back. It wasn't welcome anything back. About community back. For me. It was all about...
I think that that's a very unique perspective, and one that's actually very cool to share. Because there's so many people that get into motorcycle culture after the fact. And I think that a lot of people feel like embarrassed about it, that maybe they're in their 30s or 40s and they're just getting into bikes, and they're like, feel like they have to pretend like, oh, I know I've been in this forever. And it's like, no, you don't have to do that, dude. At least maybe around somebody else, but not around us.
Mm-hmm.
And not around anybody who actually cares about getting people into motorcycles.
Mm-hmm.
You can say whatever. You could be 80 years old and have gotten into motorcycles yesterday. I will welcome you with open arms.
You absolutely know,
gentle open arms, because you're fragile. All right, you guys ready for another ASMR? Never made the 12th step sound.
Jesus Christ.
Just call me Gallagher, dude. You're in the splash zone. Sorry, David. I think it was just condensation. It wasn't actual beer, but...
No, it went right in my eye.
I'm sorry.
You're good.
So yeah, you'll be welcomed with open arms. It doesn't matter when you started. You don't have to have a pedigree. Sometimes I feel bad about talking about it, because I will like... I'm just... Not to say I'm fascinated with myself, but sometimes I'm fascinated by the fact that I've been doing something for so long
mm-hmm.
that I go like, oh God, dude, I've been riding my whole life. And I'll just say like, ah, I've been riding for, oh my God, dude, I've been riding motorcycles mm-hmm. longer than I haven't been. Yeah. And so it's just, and been enamored with them the whole time. And so sometimes I feel like when I say that, it'll make people feel like that they can't have a voice unless they've also had that mm-hmm. amount of time. And I think that's total bull crap.
Yeah.
The only thing you can't, if somebody ever uses time as a way to win an argument, like I've been doing this for X amount, that's a really lazy way to win an argument or say that you're better than somebody, because that's the one thing that you cannot defeat.
Yeah, even time doesn't mean shit, because like I know people who have been riding just as long as I have and they are shit riders.
Me.
You have your moments. You're not the best at directions.
I've just like I've been so mediocre for years. Like, aggressive mediocrity.
Oh, my face was on
camera.
It's
really just directions.
Yeah.
Like, you're fine at riding, but God, directions, dude.
Confidence?
Like,
Okay. You guys ever meet a confident alpha male? External male. Yeah. Shelby, man. What's up, Shelby?
God, is that why Kyle drives like that too?
Who confidently sends us back towards Albuquerque when we're 300 miles past it.
I'll go. I will go in the wrong direction confidently.
I've been on the road with you. Like, well, we're going down a dirt road, David. And he's just like... so mad that we're going down a dirt road, so angry, cursing God, like, and just like, I don't know where we are.
That's the thing about motorcycles, though, is that you have to be traveling down a road. So that does get frustrating when I'm lost, because it's like you have to move. That's, you know, you're moving, and so you're moving in a direction, and I'm like, you have to go down a road, so it's either that way or the other way. I don't know. It's a weird. That's a weird philosophical thing. But I will go the wrong direction confidently, because you have to make a choice. You know? So I'm not afraid to make a choice.
I know.
I think I should be more afraid to make a choice.
You should.
But I am unafraid.
I know.
Okay, so somebody says, I was anxious and nervous all day at the show. I am almost 50, and I'm not sure I'll ever be comfortable around real bikers. So I don't think I'll ever be comfortable either. And that's something I've kind of realized. I'm just kind of uncomfortable socially, but you just kind of get used to being uncomfortable and then adjust to that, I think.
What's a real biker?
I don't know.
I think the second that you put your hand on the handlebars and your feet off the ground, you're a biker.
Yeah. First day, first minute.
Yeah.
So I think he's probably talking about like fucking leather pirates. Which is like, I'm all about it, dude. Cosplay yourself up, man. If you like to play dress up and go out to the biker event in your leather and have fun, I'm here for it. I think that can be a little off-putting for people who don't know how to take somebody like that.
Yeah.
But I promise you, so here's this.
They're just like playing
dress up. They're just people.
Imagine them like...
It's like the Ren Faire.
Yeah, that's what I was just about to say, is like people at bike shows are dressing up like the same way that people dress up at the Renaissance Festival. Like, they're nerds, dude.
Yeah.
Bikers are fucking nerds. Like, I'm going to put on my silly little outfit so I can go ride with my friends on my bike.
Which I'm here for it.
Yeah.
Like, do it, dude. I like it. The Raven Kane goes me. And he had a big bet. He definitely looks like a biker.
No, but today I was
He's like the nicest dude. He's just like anyone.
Yeah, I know. But today I'm at Burt's, and one of the groups there, I don't know if they're 1%ers or not, the enforcers, but all of them in their 60s, all of them wearing the same vest, same t-shirt, same pants. And I'm looking at them because you guys might as well be Boy Scouts. I swear to God, y'all look exactly the same. It's like, and part of liking bike is your expression of which bike you choose, how you choose to ride it, where you choose to ride it. What you know, the accessories you put on it, what you dress. I think that as soon as you start trying to assimilate and try to just do the same as somebody else that is doing and not doing what you want yourself, I think you've lost the plot.
Yeah, I think so too. Although I will give a little bit of credence to a lot of those guys who really enjoy the militaristic aspect of motorcycle clubs and having like a uniform.
Oh, I'm not against it at all.
No, it's not for me.
But all I'm saying is that they've given up their sense of independence and their own sense of self for the sake of a group. And I just don't think that there's strength in numbers as it pertains to being, you know, yourself.
Yeah, I like my group to look like a bunch of freaks and weirdos. A lot of people think I have a harem. I don't. I got a freak show, baby. I don't have that either. I'm just kidding. I'm a nerd in real life. Anyway, if you want to dress up in leather, that's totally fine. I like it too. I think that leather looks cool. When I look at somebody who's like got some really cool leather accessories on, I'm like, that dude looks badass. It's not for me. I prefer denim. So there's Hellbent for leather is Judas Priest, and then Hellbent, and then I forget what they said. It's something for denim was Turbo Negro, which was a play on Judas Priest. Was something about denim.
Just be careful how you pronounce that.
Turbo Negro.
I thought you was my friend.
Yeah. Hey man, I was cool, dude. I got a friend. Yeah, but we like freaks and weirdos, man. It's just one of the things that always drives me nuts about people and the like what you would call the woke agenda, which I'm just like, whatever, dude. It's just advertising. Who cares? I'm like, God, that's what the campouts look like already. Like literally the campout looks like a Pepsi commercial. It's just like people from every which way you can possibly imagine. And that's motorcycles too, because that's the common denominator, is you don't have to be from anywhere to like going fast. You don't have to be any kind of color, creed, religion. I guess creed is religion, right? Ooh. Whatever, you know.
I thought it was that really fucking grunge band.
Creed?
Yeah.
No, Creed, the greatest American band of all time?
Yeah.
Okay, well, they're not grunge. They're just the greatest rock and roll band
ever. I thought they were like, in comparison.
Love that, that dude's voice is sick.
They do the song Black Hole Sun, right?
Yeah. No, Creed actually sang I Don't Want Nothing But a Good Time and Unskinny Bop, two great American hits.
Hey. Ride Red, congratulations on the new bike, man.
Oh, dude, hell yeah. Welcome to FXR life. You'll fix it more than you ride it. But, I mean, that's cool. It's because most FXRs are road hard, put away wet.
Pierre is in the chat, and I just wanted to shout out Pierre for being our biggest Brapstar fan.
What's up, Pierre? Pierre
ordered like 10 shirts, man.
Yeah.
So thank you, Pierre. He's in French Canada.
You are single-handedly producing the Brapstar channel right now.
So every time I hear, because David, to me, you don't even have even a Canadian accent, let alone a French Canadian accent. You just sound like you're from like, I don't know, like Ohio or something. You have like no accent whatsoever. Like you would call it an American accent if you were in Europe or something.
Americans would call me American. Canadians call me American.
Yeah. Do they say you have an American
and Europeans accent? Can pick out the Canadian.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So every time we've been, and I've only seen him do this a couple times, but when we're traveling on motorcycles, and a lot of times we're going to like national parks and stuff like that, and you get people from all over. And all of a sudden I'll see David start speaking French with somebody. I'm like, what the hell? It's just like weird. It's like you talking to an alien or something. It's like every time I hear you speak French, I'm like, what the fuck? I didn't know you could do that. it's like as weird as if you just did like four backflips or something. I'm like,
wait till you come to Montreal, man. It's insane.
I don't know. I'm sure it's not weird for you. You're just like, yeah, whatever.
It's not.
It's just like weird. Like you just grew like a third arm or something.
Yeah, it's like seeing your teacher at the mall, you know?
Dang, dude, that's actually a very good one. Seeing your teacher at the mall, you're like, I didn't know you existed outside of here.
It's like watching a dog walk on its hind legs.
Well, I thought my
what did you say was a supporter?
Pierre.
Yeah.
Forgot one of those boxes there. Is he on the chat?
Yeah, he's in the chat.
Oh, Pierre Page.
Okay, so someone named Alien in the chat has 10 times now. Please, Shade Tree, can I have the red, white, and blue weirdo sticker? Please.
Oh, dude.
They've said it 10 times.
So
I just found it.
Okay.
And we own, this is the last one that exists. If you email me at shaylisi@brapstar.com, I will mail it to you. Just in the email, put whatever address you want me to mail it to. That's the last one.
Just made a few hundred pins.
Oh, like hell
that,
yeah.
Of that design.
You did?
Yeah.
Cool.
They're going to take a month to get here.
Yeah, right? Yeah. I'm also making socks right now.
I'm drinking Grolsch, man. Grolsch was very popular with yuppies in like the 90s. You see, you're laughing because you know what I'm talking about, right? It was like Grolsch would be like what Patrick Bateman would drink.
Yeah, no. You know? And they keep the bottles on the wall.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. So here's something
it's good beer, though.
Decent beer. Here's an alcohol that's like past my age range that like didn't exist. You know how like alcohols come and go, like Four Loko, you know, whatever.
You can still buy a Four Loko.
Yeah, but it's not the same. Anyways, so I saw this picture today. It's it was on the messy houses you just have to zoom into the background of Facebook group. And it was a house full of Zima. Do you guys remember that?
Zima. Yeah, I remember.
You guys remember
well.
Zima?
Called
I feel
the
like
cheerleader killer.
I feel like everybody in the chat and you guys, because you're older than
I feel like
will remember Zima.
If you had Zima in your house,
I had to look it up what Zima was. I didn't know.
There's a you are a statutory grape.
Dude,
grapist.
This house was like
what are you doing, dude?
A hoarder's house, but all they had was Zima.
I don't know what they're preparing for, but they should probably be in jail. No, I remember. So Zima came out when I was in high school. I remember it was like a big, like, it was what you got in high school if you wanted girls to drink, right? Because it's
which is
like
White Claws now, yeah. Essentially.
So it was like if you went
I
out
wonder
to
if White
party
Claws
and you're
will
like 16
it.
Years old and you're like, I want the girls to drink. You know, you had to have Zima. And they would do like the same thing that people do with like Lean. They put Skittles in it. Yeah, it was like Zima, and then you pour Skittles down the neck. Or at least that's what they did in Florida.
Yeah.
This is the wrong one, Cindy.
Oops.
Well, no, it's fine. It's a Forgotten Angels one, but I wanted her to get me the... I ride for the Forgotten. It's probably not it either. I'm screwed up.
Anyway, Pierre, we got something for you. Buck Brown used to deliver Zima. Something different. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, Smirnoff Ice. That was the other one, too.
Does that not exist anymore?
I
feel like
you can
still buy that.
You can still get Smirnoff Ice. It's not, you don't see it regularly, though.
Yeah, but it's like it's not as popular. Like, what was the White Claw of its day, you know?
Was Smirnoff Ice.
It was Smirnoff Ice,
yeah.
And before
yeah.
that, it was Zima.
Yeah.
You know?
And there's stuff before that, too. Like, yeah. So, you know what the...
Bartles and James.
You know, you said it, not me. You're Dave. Arbor Mist has always been a standby.
David, you're timing people out.
What's that?
You're timing people out on accident.
I'm doing... Oh, shoot. I'm so sorry. Sorry.
Are you trying to go to the
sorry, Ron. No, it was tied up by David Tyler for 60 seconds. I totally didn't mean to do that.
You got fucking put in timeout on accident.
Oh, man. Well, I know where the second mug's going then.
David doesn't do mayonnaise on his french fries. He does gravy.
Yeah. No, actually, I did mayonnaise about a week ago. I went to McDonald's, and they literally didn't have those anything in that squish bottle, so I asked for some mayonnaise.
So I love mayonnaise on fries, but my favorite one is, so when you say salad dressing, what do you think? Because there's only one thing that comes to my mind.
Vinaigrette.
Yeah, there's vinegar in salad dressing.
So the only salad dressing we ever had as kids, this was on the dressing on every single one, was mayonnaise mixed with ketchup.
What the?
That was how you made salad for forever. I was like, oh, yeah. That's just salad dressing.
Yeah, wrong. Yeah, actually, the proper name for french fries with mayonnaise is Belgium Fritz.
So I would love to go to Belgium. It's the largest. It's just a country full of breweries. And also, it's just like France, but they love beer instead of champagne.
Mm-hmm.
And french fries. Yeah. Or like, I guess, Belgium frites. And so I would really love to go to Belgium. Very excited to go to Belgium one day. I'm excited to go to France, too. I think that French cuisine and French food, French cuisine, French drink, like, it's like everything's so decadent.
Yeah, no, you know? Cindy actually and I were invited by Liren's mom and her stepdad to go to Bordeaux to stay at a villa.
Dog, right? Oh.
I don't know. I honestly don't know.
You can drink whatever you want, man. Utah mayo and ketchup is called fry sauce. I always heard it called fancy sauce. But we would just call it was just salad dressing. If you got really lucky, you put a scoop of relish into it. So you put a scoop of dill relish into it. And that was salad dressing.
That sounds more like tartar sauce.
You know, it's totally possible to be poor and still have like okay food.
We also dessert was always green maraschino cherries.
For dessert?
That was dessert all the time.
Ours was molasses cake.
Oh God, I thought mine was bad.
Wow. and you know what the it was molasses cake and the icing was just like brown sugar. She would just melt brown sugar.
Brown sugar. Yeah, I mean, you can't go wrong with melting brown sugar.
Yeah, with a little butter in it.
My grandma would do all that weird stuff like that all the time, too. She would just, she was also insane. So sometimes I'll say the things my grandmother used to make us, and everyone's like, that sounds crazy. I'm like, oh, yeah, dude. Ronnie Reagan let her out of a mental institution just in time to babysit us while my mom went to nursing school and then never did anything with her degree. So my grandma used to just boil sugar in water, which is how you make Kool-Aid. Mm-hmm. But never put any Kool-Aid in it. She would just give us the sugar water as like a treat, like cold sugar water.
Your children are not butterflies.
And so I remember bringing it in one time for like show and tell. I was like, oh, I brought in a treat for everyone. I brought in like sugar water. Cause I was like excited. I was like, this is. Cause at the time, when you're fucking eight, I'm saying like everyone, I'll say that story. Everyone's like, oh, you poor bastard. You didn't have any of these treats. Like, I fucking know. Dude, I loved it. I was like, oh, yeah, well, let me get a freaking shot of that stuff. It's awesome. I was excited about it.
Yeah, so, see, it only sucked when we found out. It's like,
it didn't suck until you compare it.
Exactly. You know, I had no idea there was such thing as a cookie with stuffing in it until I was like 10 or 11. Honestly. We used to go to these two little bastard kids. I hope they're not ever going to hear this. Richard and Robert Mabry. They're little pricks. But we liked them because they had money and they would give it to us.
Oh, I thought you meant like literal bastard children.
No, they're
weird for you to say that, David, as somebody who runs a charity.
You know what? These are two kids that literally said to us, you talk to your mom like that? And they go, yeah, if she doesn't do what we want, we'll beat her ass. At 12.
Yikes.
They literally said that.
It's like some fucking, like they need the nanny to come.
Yeah. But like I said, they had paper routes. They gave us money, so they're okay with us. I didn't have standards back then.
I was a poor kid. Morals or values or anything else. I get it.
Dry Heat Doug goes, the Earth is 4.5 billion years old, and Twisted Tea happened in our lifetime. It's not a coincidence that this is the best time on our Earth.
He's hard to argue with.
Every time is the best time on Earth. You go back like 100 years before cars, they were happy that horses became domesticated.
Yeah, but they didn't have no twisted tea, all right? Yeah.
No, they had moonshine.
No, dude. You know what I want to go back to is like... I don't understand.
Even water, I don't care.
I didn't sign up like for women's rights to work. That wasn't agreed on for future generations, and I think we should take that back. I didn't ask for this life. I just want to cook and clean and
I'll have a chat with the ghost of Rosa Parks for you.
I didn't ask for the right to work.
Yeah, she didn't stand up for you. She stood up for your sister.
Yeah.
She likes to work, right? She's a worker.
Well, it's like, it should be like the right to work. Like, someone just...
Somebody help Shay, help.
I don't dream of like what's my dream job? I don't dream of labor. Like,
so you want a sugar daddy?
No.
It's not wrong. There's nothing wrong with it. I know some sugar mamas that wanted sugar daddies.
I don't want a sugar daddy because I am not. See, I'm only like a slut in theory, not in practice. Like there's not in practice.
Alright, let's hear the comments go now.
Yeah, I can't imagine I'd ever want to give any sugar.
No.
So.
Yeah, it's funny because Cindy and I were talking about prostitution the other day because she was like, it's terrible that these women have to debase themselves. I'm like, a lot of these girls are choosing to do it, especially like in Vegas and certain places where it's been legalized, where they're safe and they're making a shit ton of money, you know. I've never had a sugar-free Orange Crush.
Dude, the new sugar-free stuff is so good.
Is it really?
Oh, you can't tell the difference.
I will be the judge of that.
You cannot, dude. It tastes just like an Orange Crush. I feel like I'm getting diabetes as soon as I sip it, but it's zero sugar. Wow. I swear to God. Dude, if you drank 5 years ago, if you drank a diet orange soda, you'd be like, this tastes like cough syrup.
Yeah.
It's weird. The new whatever.
I can tell the little aftertaste of it, but as soon as you drink it, it tastes exactly like Orange Crush.
I freaking love it, man. I do that. I was gonna say I crush that stuff, but I do, man. I love orange soda.
Dude, the comments. I just want to say the comments in the live stream today are just so good. Like, somebody all just right. says weed.
David, shield yourself.
Oh, God.
All right. I know to do it now. That was a, I felt bad about that.
Yeah, I just want to say happy birthday to everyone who smokes weed.
420, man.
It's 420. I know that you picked the end of the raffle special for today. Because, like,
30 minutes.
Yeah. So,
so if you're a last
so
minute
So everyone light it up.
Now's the time, dude.
And buy your raffle ticket.
So now's your last chance. One of the cool things about this, man, a lot of people do raffles, dude. A lot of people do. And that's fine. I don't want to take anything away from anybody who does a raffle. But there's so many people. Daniel Brees, man. Thank you, dude. He says, I'll be, wait, never mind. I mean, I don't know. It's a legitimate statement. He left a super chat. I have to read it out loud. He says, I'll be your sugar daddy, Shay. We can sit on the couch together and play Pokemon. Now,
which Pokemon?
I would say which Pokemon, yeah.
Which Pokemon?
That's important, dude.
Important.
Are you
playing
Pokemon poser?
Are we playing like Pokemon Snap?
Yeah.
Pokemon Stadium?
You got a couple of freaking Game Boy Colors out?
Yeah, like are we bringing up the Game Boy Color? Are we
playing the newest Pokemon on Wii?
What are we playing?
Hell yeah, praise be to Snoop Dogg. I love it.
I would like to, I feel like, you know, I feel like I would just get along with Snoop Dogg. Like we just,
is
like,
he smoking weed again?
He never stopped. It was all advertising campaign.
That's what I thought. Somebody told me he was never going to smoke again. I'm like, there's no
way. You know, you guys, I'm not smoking anymore. But I ain't smoking any less.
Was that fucking, that's the Wayans line. I have a drink now and then, like now and again. Gma Rides, what's up? Hey, Gma Rides, Daniel Brees, all you guys, you could for, I guess it would be double plus five what you donated, which we appreciate very much, and we'll donate that to Forgotten Angels. But don't do that. Do not donate to the chat. I mean, I'm not saying don't. I'm just saying you can buy a raffle ticket.
If you might win donate the to the chat, you're officially my sugar daddy or mommy.
Right. Well, you got to say which Pokemon you go.
But you have to also say what your favorite Pokemon is while you attach your super chat.
The way that Gma Rides just dropped that sounds like she has experience. She goes like, yeah, the sugar daddy thing's highly overrated. I feel, dude, like, that's six
grandma,
words.
Grandma, what?
That's six words, but there is a novel behind those six words.
Oh, I'm telling you.
I'm just saying, dude.
The secret is out.
Anyway, 28 minutes left on the raffle. So what I was saying about the... this one is that a lot of people do raffles. I'm not taking anything against that. There's actually a huge backlash right now against raffles on Instagram. And it's mainly people who raffle like old bikes, like panheads and shovel heads for profit. They'll do
I've been seeing that because they're all fucking fixed, dude.
Well, that's what people say.
Well, I'm on the
anyone can say
anything.
Yeah,
but I'm on the conspiracy theory side.
So anyway,
I'm on this side of the table where I'm like, oh yeah, that shit's fixed as fuck.
Republican.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I mean, I've seen a lot of people, like there's this guy 3G Nook that a lot of people talk shit about. I know that guy.
Oh, okay. Well, I'm not even talking about anyone in particular.
So 3G Nook does, his shit's not fixed, dude. And he raffles bikes like every other week and it's a legitimate business. It's how he makes his money and like, mm-hmm. whatever. Nobody has to buy the ticket. You know, nobody's holding.
No,
under
I know. I shouldn't say that because then
I'm sorry. I'm not.
No. You're right. Because
I just, like, know
I'm
some
not.
Of these guys,
no, I'm not even talking about anyone in particular. I'm just like feeding into the conspiracy theories.
Yeah, and I understand why people get mad about it because they're like, it makes these bikes like even more unobtainium. Like, dude, a knucklehead's already like so unobtainable. It's unobtainable for us, Shay. Like, I ain't got knucklehead money. You know?
Oh, hell no.
So I even got panhead money. So it's like people see these things and it just makes them like so much more out of reach. So I understand the kickback against them. And I understand that it's just like a lot of them are shitty. So they do like is a big kickback against the word survivor, which I do think like survivor choppers are very cool. A lot of people think they're cool. But there's this big kickback against raffling survivor choppers because they're like, oh, they're just using that as a way to sell something shitty without fixing it. They're like, oh, it's a survivor chopper.
God.
I'm not touching it. And it's just, they're like, oh, basically, you just like, you have a bike that you got to have a storage unit. You're not.
Oh, my God. You could make like a whole YouTube deep dive conspiracy theory. Like,
I know,
like
I just, Oompaville. I know a lot of these guys.
Oompaville type video about it.
So it's
it.
Like, I know these guys. So I was like, I'm not, because like Easy Company does it, 3G Nook, I know, like I know these people. And I know they're both bored.
You don't have to say their names.
I don't mind, I'll say them. I got no secrets.
You can always say they're a friend of the channel. Kidding, I have no, you go, they're a friend of the channel, right? That's what H3 does. They're a friend of the channel. Friend of the channel.
Anyway, dude, they're always like $100.
Dude, this guy goes, I barely have head money.
And so I don't know, man. Everyone says 3G Nook live streams his just like we do when he pulls winners. He writes them down.
Yeah, I feel like if you're not live streaming your winner, it's probably fixed.
That's why we always live stream.
Yeah, that's why I'm like feeding into the conspiracy theories of like, oh, it's fixed, because I'm like, yo, motherfucker, we do raffles. I know how it works, and if you're not live streaming your shit, like,
yeah. Well, you just want people to know like a place where they can go and like see who got called and know that and, like, hear their voice. Lucky Yump says, I ride for the Forgotten. I still have the sticker David gave me on my Silverwing. And he says his favorite Pokemon is Charmander.
Oh, so he's a sugar daddy of the channel tonight. Thank you, Lucky Yump, for being our biggest sugar daddy of the night, donating $20 for the Forgotten.
You don't feel bad, Alien. Don't feel bad if you're broken. You can't buy a ticket. So I want to say this right now. We only got 24 minutes left before the raffle's over. But Forgotten Angels is for people who don't have anything. Now, not necessarily for people who are 42 and don't have anything, because, you know, they're trying to help people who are just freshly 18 years old and put on the street and don't have anything. So when someone's like, I'm sorry, I can't donate, I don't have any money, I don't want you to feel bad, because, like, that's... What do you think charity's for? Charity's not for... If somebody has a bunch of money and they can donate to charity, the charity's not for them. They're helping, you know? So it's like, if you don't have anything, don't feel bad, dude. You should focus on getting yourself into a place that's better. You don't have to worry about donating to charity, you know? I don't know. I feel like I'm explaining this poorly. But it's like, you know, a lot of the young men and women that Forgotten Angels helps out, they don't have $25 to donate to buy a raffle ticket. So, and if they spent $25 on a raffle ticket, Dave would probably yell at them. And first off, they shouldn't do it anyway, because it's like, seems like kind of a conflict of interest. But anyway, David would admonish them, rightfully so, for essentially gambling $25. Because that's not what they should be doing. That's not how they should be living their life. If you are behind the eight ball and you're under the gun and it's time to really like pull yourself up by your bootstraps, that's not what you should be doing. Now, if you have enough extra that you can buy a $25 raffle ticket, that's awesome. But don't look at it as oh, I'm getting a chance to win a bike. What you should look at it as, I'm getting a chance to help somebody who has less than me. And making a sacrifice to help somebody who has less than you is one of the most amazing things you can do when you have extra. When you look around yourself and you have extra, you live in a state of largesse, which I do as well. I'm a very lucky person. I work hard, but I've also been lucky. And so I have extra. And so being able to take some of that extra that I don't necessarily need, could I figure out something to do with it? Sure. But you could figure out, if you tried hard enough, what to do with $1 billion. You could figure it out. You know, it might be ridiculous, but you'd figure something out. But if you look around yourself and you realize that you have extra and you'd like to help somebody who has less, I think that's an amazing selfless thing that you can do. And if you have extra, it doesn't do anything to you. But if you have nothing, or you're right on the wire, or if the entire amount of your extra money is $25, you should not be buying a raffle ticket for anything, no matter if it's for charity or if it's for profit. It doesn't matter. And I know that's counterintuitive to getting money into the raffle to help charity, but we will never not say that, you know. And David has these conversations all the time with people. You know, I don't ever want people to overextend themselves and put themselves in a situation where they have less, or they have to they're hurt because they were trying to help somebody else. That hurts the cause. It doesn't help it. That makes another person who's in a bad place. We're trying to get people out of bad places, not put them in there. Anyway, so that's that. But if you have enough, if you have some extra money, there's 20 minutes left. It's 8:40. I can't say that enough. If you have a little extra, you can buy a $25 raffle ticket, but just don't do it if you don't have it, okay? That just would break my heart, dude. There's plenty of ways to help. You know, you could tell somebody about it. I say that to people all the time. I get so many comments, too. David, I get them all the time. Like, the majority of comments when I share a post is people being like, oh, I would buy one. But I hear about people, like, having lost their jobs and all this stuff. I'm just like, that's heartbreaking. Because you see somebody who wants to help but can't. I'm like, dude, focus on helping yourself, man. And if you want to help, you can tell somebody. There are ways you can help that are free. You can share a post. You know, you can tell somebody about it. You know, you don't have to. Monetarily helping is amazing. But there are lots of ways to help that don't involve spending a single dime. Jamie Sampagnaro says, this is from the USPS. Were you the one who was helping? Let me see. I don't see an eye patch in that picture. Oh, dude, if you sent me a postal hat, email Shay, dude. Please, send Shay an email. I would love to have a USPS hat. That would make my day. Lucky Yump bought $420 worth of tickets. You're the man, dude. I love it. You guys are awesome, man. Now, it feels amazing to have a group of people out there who are so willing to go above and beyond, to sacrifice something. And even if you have a lot of extra money, something that I always preach is sacrifice something for it. So it's like, I don't care if you've got, you took that $25 to buy a raffle ticket and you're a millionaire. You know what? Next time you pull into McDonald's or Burger King, I'm a BK man myself. I roll with the king. Next time you roll in there, just roll right out. Don't get it. Don't be like, you're going to get a freaking Whopper with cheese, a number one with cheese, large fries, Diet Pepsi to drink. Just roll back out and don't get it. Go eat at home. Because now you've made, now I know you can afford it. You can afford both. But now you've made a sacrifice that you've taken something away from your own life. Something that you would have otherwise enjoyed. And I think that that is a really interesting and healthy thing to do. If you take, even though you don't have to, even though you can afford both, when you go like, okay, I bought $25 raffle ticket, I'm not going to eat lunch out today. When you do that, I think that it puts you on the level of what it means to, or what it feels like to have to be on level with somebody who has nothing. Because there are people out there that this money is helping who can't afford $5 to eat, let alone a $12 freaking combo at Burger King that you shouldn't be eating anyway because it's bad for you. So it's sacrificing something out of your own life that you could otherwise afford after you make a donation, I think, to me, really brings it home. And I've said this before. I hope some people have actually tried it and done it just so... Because it's like, you know, it just means nothing. You take a, you've got a hundred, if $100 means nothing to you and you throw it at some raffle tickets, thank you. But also, like, figure out a way to make it mean something to you. And it'll be so much more fulfilling, I promise you. I think so, anyway. I can't believe that drinking a soda with sugar in it is better than drinking a diet soda. I just cannot believe that. There's no way. Sugar's so bad for you.
Yeah, there's like six times the amount of sugar, isn't it?
Yeah. And no offense, Motonog. I'll hear people say, they're like, just drink a regular soda. I'm like, dude, if you, a regular soda has 44 grams of sugar in it. Now, if you've led a slightly shady lifestyle like I have, imagine what 44 grams looks like. I know you guys know what 3.5 grams looks like. Imagine what 44 grams looks like. Okay, and imagine just consuming that in one 12-ounce serving. That's insane. Like, dude. Like, sugar, there's no way. 44 grams in a 12-ounce serving. There's no way that that's better for you than a diet soda. I cannot believe that. Like, diet soda is essentially water. With some chemicals in it. Like, the same chemicals are in a regular soda. Just the difference is aspartame. And the amount of the grams of aspartame are so insignificantly small compared to the 44 grams. Imagine what that looks like. Imagine a 3.5 gram bag, and now imagine 44 grams. That's an insane amount of powder to put in your body. It's wild.
Yeah, there's 30 times the amount of calories in a regular Coke than a Diet Coke.
It just is. It's a, any. That's an insane amount of any. It takes up like a quarter of the can. The amount that it takes up in there. They have to boil it in or else it'd just be sludge at the bottom. Yeah, of course aspartame's bad for you, but there's no way that a 12-ounce serving with a insanely small amount of aspartame is worse for you than a 12-ounce serving with 44 grams of sugar in it. It's very hard for me to believe that. Of course I'm comparing two unhealthy things, but they're still measurable, aren't they? I think that they're measurable, and if you were to measure them, that 44 grams of sugar is not better for you. Anyway, I'm just saying, dude. Aspartame has this like thing where like, oh, it's like gives you like super cancer instantaneously. I'm just like, yo, dude, my dad drank Diet Coke every freaking day, dude. Drank 6 cans a day. He lived to be 101. He also smoked for 50 years. You know, bacon and eggs every day, but I'm just like, I don't know, dude. People act like drinking a can of Diet Coke is going to immediately give you butt cancer.
You want to talk about aspartame again?
What about monk fruit? What about, you know, what about Zevia? I mean, I don't know, dude. It's just like, it's just a weird thing that people just are like, are you a molecular biologist? Where's the study? Why is it bad for you?
You know
Show
what
me.
You should do? I saw this TikTok of a girl who was Red 40 maxing. You should do aspartame maxing.
It's actually, so I switched specifically from Monster, which I love Monster Energy, right? The sugar-free ones. And I switched from that to C4 only because C4 doesn't put any dye in it. And it was weirding me out that Monster, all Monster, even the white Monster has dye in it. They put dye in it to make it like opaque. I'm like, why would you do this? It's so weird. And C4 is all like completely clear. So it was weird me out that they put dye in it. So I was like, that's why I drink
C4
now.
Why does it weird you out that there's dye in it?
I just was like, it's unnecessary.
I know, but there's dye in everything.
You can't see inside the can. So it was weird. I was like, why are you putting this in here into a can that's opaque? I can't see inside here.
Yeah,
that's kind
of weird.
It's bizarre that they would do that. There's no reason at all. I cannot see the liquid. So like, why are you putting dye into this? Especially the white one. Like, you could just make it clear. It's the only one that would be okay to make clear. It's like Crystal Pepsi, but no, they put this thing in it and it just looks like, I'm like, Sprite's clear, dude. Sprite doesn't have any dye in it. It's like, why'd you put this dye in it, dude? It makes it look like soda water that's been shaken up and has like a bunch of small bubbles in it. It's like this weird opaque color. It's bizarre.
I don't know.
Anyway, 13 minutes. 13 minutes to win a unicorn. Aspartame is rat poison, flips on it. All right, I'll stop.
Got me there. Are you trying to say I'm a rat?
Do you drink any diet stuff?
Yeah, because that's what you buy.
Oh, okay, yeah, but you don't drink
it
regularly.
I have no preference. I don't really drink soda unless I, like, I don't know. I'm craving it? I don't know. I don't really regularly.
You know what I'm craving? I'm craving a CBX 1000, but I can't. Yeah. I will not get one. But it's going to go to somebody. Share it. Tell a friend. We have 12 minutes left, and we're pulling a winner. It's an amazing bike. It's one of the ones you could ride home. Although plenty of people have ridden home sketchier things.
Yeah,
so I guess you could ride. Yeah, Larry's riding one home. Our man rode the blue shovelhead back to Colorado. He made it.
To Colorado?
Yeah.
Yeah, Larry's driving back to Texas.
Good job.
On Tuesday, this Tuesday. I bought him his ticket three days ago. Yeah.
So that is a part of it. So if you were wondering, like, yes, that's a real part of it. You don't have to do it. We'll also just take the bike to you. But if you should so choose, you can fly to Tampa on a one-way ticket and ride the motorcycle back. We'll make that happen. And you won't even have to, like, if you don't want to stay in a hotel, we'll help you out. Like, if you don't have, so some people don't have hotel money, which is fine. So, yeah, the CBX, I would ride that across the country. I understand some people would want to bring a trailer. They'd want a trailer just because they don't want to put the miles on it, which I totally understand. But it's totally fine, dude. I've been riding it all over the place. I probably put like 600 or 700 miles on it. It's amazing.
I don't want to. I'm nervous.
I'm just not nervous to ride anything, I guess. Yeah. I don't really care.
It's just like, I just...
No shit. Every single person on this channel knows you don't ride riding sketch.
Yeah. Or nice. Like, I'm like, I don't care if it's expensive. Yeah, but
all I want is you start riding sketchy bikes with me. You're riding with everybody else but me.
But it's really nice to ride it with you because I'm like, you know, I got someone who won't leave you behind.
Well, I probably wouldn't care if I could flat foot it. But, you know, that's what makes it me nervous.
Right, right, to drop it. You know, it's like, got plastic bearings.
Yeah, I don't want to fuck up the paint, you know, like.
Yeah, it is. It's really nice.
Yeah, so it's just not worth it. Risk versus reward.
Yeah. Yeah, I hope whoever wins it rides the hell out of it. Would it make, it would make it to Alaska, easily.
Yeah, like Road King Kong.
Yeah, yeah. Road King Kong has
been back and forth three or four times now.
I know,
right?
Seriously, and then halfway back.
Like, I know, that's awesome. So many miles on that bike, I love it, and he's an awesome dude too. It's just
the saddle. It's not that tall. It's a little tall for Shay, but if you're above 5'4", you're fine.
Yeah, like even then, I could probably ride it. I just don't want to risk it.
Yeah, it's not like a super light bike either. Mm-hmm. It's not crazy heavy, but I mean, it's probably weighs like 600 pounds. Yeah, but like,
what happens if, I don't know, I have loose footing, like, because of sand on the road?
You would drop it.
Yeah, not going to do that. I don't want to do that.
Anyway, well, in 9 minutes, it's a moot point, because it's going to belong to somebody else.
I know, right?
Once it belongs to somebody else, except for the Tour Glide, which I've been riding all over the place to see if I can make it have a problem, in 9 minutes, it's somebody else's bike. And once it belongs to somebody else, I stop riding them. I'll ride them enough to keep them, like, so it's in working order. Because the worst thing you can do to a motorcycle is not ride it. It's the worst thing you can do to anything is not use it. I feel like they lose some part of their soul when you don't use them. Unless they're at a place like Barber where they... And guess what? Every single motorcycle at Barber is in running condition. They run every single one.
Yeah, it's crazy. Somebody asked me earlier what my first motorcycle was. You can hold that up. This is it right there. It's a 1972 Kawasaki KE90 dual sport.
Dude, the 90, the two smoke, dude. That's we got to get it. You back out on the trails on a two stroke, man.
Yeah, I love that.
We will do it soon.
I noticed you ended the last video of me whipping out on the water.
Push it. Didn't crash, did you? That was a good save. That was a good save, dude. Yeah, the CBX would be great next to a Bowery. The whole bike smells like, if you've ever been inside of a classic car and they have like that gasoline leather like smell, the whole bike smells like that.
Dude, that is like literally, that smell gives me PTSD from my dad and his fucking...
He had a Trans Am, right?
He had a Trans Am.
Yeah. I love that smell. So it's like getting into like oiled leather seats in a car where you a carbureted car that you can smell like gasoline, old plastic, and leather. It's just like a certain smell that old cars have that I really love, and the whole bike smells like that. It's very cool. We're getting close, dude. We got 3 minutes left. We're sorry, 7 minutes left. If you're a last minute Larry, the time is now. The time is now. In fact, like, we get up to that point where we're, like, got the last 5 minutes where it's, like, there's a delay. I think, how long is it? Like, 30 seconds?
Like, 30 seconds-ish.
Yeah. So, there's a 30-second delay. So, we get right up to the end. You're, like, I'm waiting for the last 30 seconds. Buy it before that. Because when we say it's over, it was over 30 seconds before that. So, now's the time. Pierre Page goes, I love that smell. You got people who know what I'm talking about know that smell.
No, I know that smell. I just hate that smell.
What smell is that in this one?
The classic car smell. Like you know, leather, gasoline.
Gotcha.
It's like old plastic too. Mm-hmm. That's like part of it. It sounds weird to say that, but it is. It's like the parts of the doors and the dash and stuff like that. They have back in the day, there's just a different smell to them. Now cars don't smell like anything, usually.
Mm-hmm.
For a long time that was true. Except for, weirdly, a lot of European cars, the glue that they use, especially in Florida, would make the whole car smell like Crayolas. So So I was big in Mercedes for a while. And it was, I was so awful. I was like, why am I getting into a new Mercedes in July? It smells like a box of Crayolas. Yeah, it was awful.
You can actually buy that in a spray can. Aerosol.
Crayola spray?
No. New power.
So I was at Home Depot the other day, and you can buy a smell to put in your paint.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Wow.
What smells do they have?
Lavender and vanilla. To like put into your paint can so it won't
vanilla. Smell like paint. Speaking of vanilla,
your paint will smell like vanilla.
Mentioned Brian Timms, light skinned Brian Timms.
Vanilla.
Yeah, no. But all of you who've met Brian at the campouts today, Cindy, myself, Shep, and a few other people went. If you don't know Brian played for the New England Patriots, won a Super Bowl with Tom Brady in 2017. But he's one of the mentors of our boys, and he graduated from law school this morning. We went to his graduation. It was amazing. And just a shout out to Brian. I know he's not on the channel, but at some point I'll probably send this to him so he can know how important he is to our foundation.
It was awesome. A lot of people who have been to the camp out has met him. He's been to several camp outs. And he, for a guy who wears two Super Bowl rings, he hangs out like one of the boys. Very cool, you know. And so I know Journey of Jerry have met him. He actually
he raced a Grom.
A foot race, and I think it was Journey of Jerry's Grom.
Yeah.
He won.
I think Brian won, right?
Yeah, Brian won.
Yeah. No, he was so humble.
One of the fastest dudes in the NFL.
Dude, he can run faster than a motorcycle.
Yeah, That's cool. He had everybody in tears this morning with his testimony of where he started off and where he is now with his kids and stuff like that. It's really amazing. So
yeah, Brian Timms, if you guys didn't know, was a survivor of a horrible foster care scenario, and he went on to play in the NFL and had to fight past things that I can't imagine to be one of them in a place of one of the most successful places you can imagine. You know, being a Super Bowl winning NFL team, that's insane.
And he won a championship in college, and he won a Grey Cup in Canada also with the Toronto Argonauts.
I didn't know he was gonna.
He had all three rings on today.
I told him that last time I saw him.
So if you didn't know, you know now.
I would never take those things off, dude. There are 2 minutes, dude. 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Be a hero. Be a bad person doing good things. Everyone keeps asking for that t-shirt. So believe it or not, I'm sure you do believe it. I do have a design already in mind for the bad people doing good things. That will come. I think I want to make it part of a raffle, though, like where it's like... Wolves, you know, like the one we did before with you meet the worst people on a Honda.
That was hard.
That was very hard. We'd have to do it better, for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was very hated doing that. Yeah, it was very difficult to do. But I would like to do it.
Like I think it would be a lot easier if we ran it through something different.
I like it's dangerous. How did I say it? Bad people doing good things. Yeah, dangerous women and good-hearted villains. Mm. I was like, that's the tagline. Bad people doing good things. I have an idea. I want to make it look like an old school Waylon Jennings album where they had like Wanted and they had all the people's faces in these little like portraits. Anyway, 2 minutes, dude. 2 minutes. Lost on the Road is here. We have a winner in the chat. There's actually been multiple winners in the chat, but
there might be a
Lost on the Road was the
there
first
also,
winner.
If you think about it, there might be a winner for the CBX in the chat right now.
That you could, it could be you. You could be in the chat right now, or it could be you if you buy a ticket right now, because there's 2 minutes left. It could be, potentially
Philip.
You.
Philip, he goes. I'm got one under the wire. Was there a reason you waited till 2 minutes before? Just wondering for the people who do wait. Like, is there a reason that you wait till 2 minutes before? Because, like, I dig that energy. I do that too.
A lot of people do. And the last 2 days are when everyone buys tickets.
Absolutely.
Everyone's like, everyone wins in the last 2 days. I'm like, no shit.
That's because...
That's like 90% of the tickets get sold in.
The last time I checked the raffle, it was at about 20,000.
We've done...
And now it's at 50.
Yeah, we've done... Like it's not 90%, but it's over 50%.
Yeah, I mean most
in the
of
last
it.
Two in the last 3 days, really. So everyone's like, everyone always wins in the last three
Phil
days.
Phil goes,
like,
don't try to pronounce it. Yes. I didn't.
Philip. It's like prosciutto, but with Philip. Philip Shuto. It's prosciutto.
I don't think that's right.
Yeah, well, I do, so that's all that matters. Lost on the Road. When did you buy your ticket? For the were you in the at the end or in the middle?
I forget. Yeah, yeah. But like, I'm curious, actually.
We've had people who have bought. I think, like I said, Flip won a bike. Flip and the Blue Mule.
I know that.
He's bought more tickets than anybody.
I know that Eric, who won.
But the last bike was a single ticket.
Yeah, the guy who won the FXR. Mm-hmm. He said he had bought a ticket before he came to the camp out.
And then bought another one.
But then he bought one at the camp out because he was like feeling really moved that day.
Right.
And then he won on that ticket.
So it was the last ticket he bought?
It was the ticket he had bought that day at the camp out.
That's awesome. Tell everybody you know.
Well, it's 9 o'clock now, so it's over. I'm going to pee and then we'll pull a winner. Pull a wiener.
All right. Pierre, I still haven't gotten your email yet. You need to send me an email with your mailing address. Now.
He bought his ticket 1 month after it started.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Road King was the first bike. Well, technically the first bike was Jared's bike.
Yeah, Weems.
But the first bike that Brapstar did was the Road King Kong.
Yeah, Jared's new bike was at the race bike was at Burt's Barracuda this afternoon. It is amazing. Really? He's
a pretty
special guy.
Is that event 2 days?
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I thought it was just on Sunday.
No, it was actually started yesterday. There
I
was,
didn't realize it was a
there
3 day event.
There was something going on Friday with Paul Sr. And then there was just a ton of motorcycles today. And there's something going on tomorrow also.
Okay. So just so you guys know, the raffle has officially closed. It is 9:01 p.m. There is a slight delay, so we will be pulling the winner here in just a second. Thank you so much to everybody who donated. If you guys are local to Tampa, Florida, or live just in the Central Florida area, we're going to be at Burt's Barracuda tomorrow for the Invitational. We're going to have the whole gang there. And we're going to go support our friend Jared Weems and his Dolly Mongrel build. So if you live if you're in Central Florida and want to hang out with us tomorrow, we will be at Burt's Barracuda. But I don't know what time because I don't know what time we're going.
I'll do it afterwards.
Okay.
What time are we going tomorrow?
Tomorrow? I don't know, man. I'll probably, I have to go pick up a bike in the morning.
Really?
Yeah.
You're picking up that bike in the morning? I thought you were going on Monday.
No. So, anyway, I can say it now. I don't like to announce the next raffle bike before. No one's seen the next raffle bike yet. Are we still on to pick that up on Monday, David?
Yep.
Okay. So, there's actually going to be two bikes for the next raffle?
One for sure.
Yeah, I guess we don't have the other one in our possession. So the next raffle is going to be two motorcycles, and I think you guys will be very excited about that one. But right now, we still have to pick up a winner for this one. Tomorrow, I got to pick up a bike tomorrow morning. That's for Joe the Mountain Jedi to do a Ran When Parked episode. But right now, the star of the show is there's a winner out there. Everyone's going to wait. I'm waking them wait. They're like,
okay.
Please, God,
yes.
Let me know.
The black guy is not cooked.
What? Wait.
He's very sober. I don't think you've ever been cooked.
Soldier of God says the black guy is cooked?
I don't think he's been cooked.
Never.
David's literally never been drunk.
Yeah. Being cooked means you're like high or drunk, right?
Yeah.
That's what I think.
Yeah. All right. I banned him. That's just a weird thing to say. I don't like that. Yeah. I was like, it's just a weird thing to say about David because I'm like, do you know David? I've never seen him drink more than 2 beers the entire time I've known him.
Yeah, but some people don't know that.
Yeah. Well, I'm just like, just to say that, I'm like, why would you just say that? Why would you say something about someone you don't know at all? You don't have no reason to be here because you're obviously not a fan.
He's obviously not.
You're not a fan
of
the channel.
He doesn't know who David
David's
is.
David's on the channel all the time.
He's not David. He's the black guy.
Yeah, yeah. He's like, fuck out of here, dude. We don't need you. I guess maybe that was a little harsh, but
I'm cooked. Yeah, I mean, Josh and I are cooked.
I am drunk.
Yeah.
David isn't.
I'm also celebrating Weed's birthday today.
Oh, is it? Was it his birthday today?
No, Weed.
Oh, Weed. Oh, Weed.
It is Weed's birthday. No, yes, marijuana.
Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Weed.
All right. The final number is $54,775.
How much?
54775.
Wow. That's fucking amazing. You guys are killing it.
It goes, it's both amazing and it goes fast. Trust me, man. But amazing, dude. It's amazing. It's amazing things. We're bad people doing good things, and together we're changing the world, man.
Together we're getting cooked.
But everyone's a winner, but there's only one winner.
Flip.
He's not a black guy. He's Canadian. I mean, this is a true statement. Well, I guess only half of it is true. He is black. So
at least half.
Yeah, half black, half Canadian.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know what my mom was doing in January of 1966.
All right, let's pick a winner.
Okay.
There are 1,113 people entered. So that's what I always say about these raffles, and I think a lot of, and I'm gonna have to like say, I'm saying this to everyone who entered, because pretty much, unless you couldn't afford a ticket, which is, as I've said before, was totally fine. Don't worry about it. I'd rather, there are many different ways to support besides monetarily. But pretty much everybody watching right now bought a ticket. And I say this all the time where people are like, oh, I have no chance of winning. It's 1 in 1,113.
Yeah, but like,
that's wild. Yeah. That's, you have better chances on this than winning your money back on a $5 scratch off.
That's why I always try and do like small raffles, like small Instagram raffles or YouTube raffles, because like the chances are pretty small if you don't.
Yeah, man, it's wild.
Go for an account that has like millions of people following them.
Yeah, it's wild, dude. 1,113. Like you buy $1,005 scratch offs and break even. You won't. You'll lose money
every time.
I don't know, man. I just always feel like that's just.
Dude, the chat. He's French Canadian.
I'm drinking Grolsch. Everyone wants to know what kind of beer I'm drinking. The only Grolsch is fine, I guess. I don't really like it that much better than any other beer. I just really like the way the bottles open. They're just very fun to open. That's why I like it so much. It is too late to buy a ticket. Oh, he's joking. And yes, Harness people are still in it. So Harness gets downloaded to the same spreadsheet that we pick the winner from. If you are in Harness, you are automatically entered for every single bike raffle we do. B Rabbit wants to know if you're gay.
Me?
He said. He just says, "Is the girl gay?"
Oh, is the girl gay?
Where are all these weird people who don't know who we are coming from?
I don't know, dude.
Is there like a bunch of extra people that just joined or something? Did someone rate us or something?
Is the girl gay?
I'm like, some dude doesn't know who David is. They don't know. I think they were trying. Like, who are these people?
I don't know.
I think they're trying to find the channel Shade Tree Doctor or something like that. Yeah. And they figure, oh, surgeon's the same one.
I don't know. I feel like being gay is a spectrum and we're all on it except for Josh.
No, I'm as straight as you can get.
So I don't know. I'm kind of gay, but I only date dudes. But I'm like into girls sexually, just not as a partner.
Get that cat off the table. Yeah, I don't know, man. Yeah, Shelby gets it. Grolsch for the bottle. I don't have anything against gay people. Hey. I'm just like, whatever the farthest straight you can get on the Kinsey scale, that's what I am.
I'm gay. Don't tell Cindy.
Yeah. I'm just like, the gayest thing about me is like, sometimes a girl wear like overalls. I'm like, that's cute. And I'm just like, oh, stupid. It's so gay.
It's also pretty gay that you like cats.
Yeah, I do like cats.
I heard that's like a gay thing.
Yeah. Shelby loves cats too. He wears a little cat ear hat when he's working on motorcycles at the Ride Factory.
I love it. It's my very favorite cute, thing actually. About
it. I do love that. That's very cool. Anyway, let's pick a freaking Serenity Kitty. See, Serenity Kitty, you always talk. I'm like, I would say like whenever a girl comments in the live stream, I was like, ooh, it's a lady dragon. Yeah. He's like, I'm a guy. I was like, oh shit, you just love cats and you're chill. Serenity Kitty. I was like, I love that, dude. Confidence. He's serene. He's a serene feline. All right. Spreadsheet time.
Yeah, I'm not gay, but I also like girls in overalls, you know?
Yeah, dude, I like softball girls.
It's like...
Like girls with like...
I'm not gay, but like...
calves.
I'm not gay, but have you seen women? Like...
Well, there's the debate, you know, on... What's better or worse or more acceptable or not, gay women or gay men?
Who's to say?
Who's to say? I hope they never ask me.
I'll tell you my opinion on that one right now.
We accept everyone, man. I mean, I guess that's not true. If you're an asshole, you can get out of here. Although we'll try to convert you to being good. I always try to give people a chance. Except when I've got a sick one on and someone starts saying that David's drunk. I'm like, God, get out of here. All right. Let's see here.
Yeah, the drawing is done by a random generator. We use Raffle Creator. And if you use Raffle Creator, there's a automatic raffle picker. Like, if you just click a button, it just says, like, choose winner now, and it just auto generates a winner from the Excel spreadsheet.
Very anticlimactic.
Yeah, it's really sucks. It's not like there's no like drum roll or spinny thing on the website. It just like is a click the winner and
emails
then,
you the winner,
and then it emails you the winner, and you check your email and it says their name. It's really boring.
Very anticlimactic, isn't it?
Yeah, it's.
Hey, it is what it is, man.
So that's how the Raffle Creator, that's the website we use, is Raffle Creator.
That's not it.
Say Raffle Creator 3 times fast. I've already said it too many times. Sometimes I feel... Yeah, there's, like, no anticipation.
Dude, I don't hate it. I just hate it because... I hate it for the people who buy a bunch of tickets because I don't want to encourage people to buy... It's another single ticket.
Well, you don't know. Did he... No. Is it just,
maybe he could have bought one at multiple times.
Yeah, like, at different times, you know? Because you're just seeing the one ticket that he bought just then. You don't know.
I don't want to say nothing because I always say, like...
You don't know.
I don't always say, like, the... the city, and then people are like, oh, it's me.
It's
I don't
definitely
want to
do
that.
No, not me. I'm not saying nothing. Yeah, don't do that.
All right.
Which is a number.
So here, I'll put it.
Okay, so we're going to call. What is SMB? Yeah, it was
we in the
stand,
middle, by the way. Huh? It wasn't.
We stand simps on this channel. If you're a simp, you can sit with us. This is the Simp Tree Army, and the Simp Tree Army is going to be calling you.
Yeah, simping ain't a crime, dude.
And if it was, I'd be fucking arrested. I would be in the dungeon for 1,000 years of simping. But
so. I'm going to deliver your motorcycle, right. Winner.
Hello?
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 Is this one Mr. Morris, a weirdo from Tennessee?
That would be me.
That would be you? Mr. Morris, I have some amazing news. The gypsy curse has been passed off. I can finally get rid of a CBX 1000. You're the proud new owner of a 1982 CBX, baby! You're live right now. You're live on air, dude. We're on a live stream, dude. You're speaking to, I don't know how many people are watching, but a few hundred.
500.
500 people are watching right now. Say something to the people, Morris.
I am blown away. I am a big fan of all of you all. I drove down there last year, rode down there rather on a Honda Fury.
He's a Fury guy! Oh, no! I love it, man. I love it.
I just cannot believe it. I am so excited, blown away. I just thank you all so much. I mean, I'm just so excited.
Morris, you got that off of one ticket, dude. That's $25 that you spent to help somebody else's life, and you got a... Nah, it ain't one of a kind. They made it for 4 years, but it's a pretty rare motorcycle. That's what... every once in a while, karma points her finger at you.
Praise God. I am just blown away. I'm so excited. I'm just so thankful for the work that you all do. And I'm glad.
Well, it's all David. It ain't me. That's David's here. This is David's phone, by the way. Here, let me give you to David. And he can say he's better with words than I am.
How you doing, Morris?
I'm doing great, David.
A lot better now.
Man,
so make sure that phone's turned so the number doesn't show.
You just have no idea how excited I am. Just glad that I could do anything to help what you all are doing. That's just so big time, man, what you all are doing down there. And I just cannot believe I have one amongst them.
Well, we know that every single person that buys a ticket, everybody wants to win. Nobody believes that they will. Yet they make the decision to support our mission no matter what, as did you. And so we're so grateful for your support of our mission. We hope you'll continue to do so. If you don't, I'm going to come and beat your ass because you just won a motorcycle off a $25 ticket. You better buy another one. Well,
dude,
I hope at least you're weak. did you win a car yesterday?
Morris, you sound so wholesome. How did you even find my channel?
Seriously, everyone's saying I can tell the bike already went to a good place.
I'm just like, what's your, dude, your fucking YouTube search history is sus, man. I don't know how you found me. You sound too nice to be watching our channel.
It gives me a balanced life.
There you go.
That was so cool, dude.
Well, I'll be in touch with you tomorrow to make arrangements for a delivery or for you to pick it up. We actually have a gentleman, Larry, who's going to be flying down from Texas on Tuesday. So we'll speak about your schedule and the timing of this. And congratulations one more time.
Man, thanks so much. No, I don't even have words anymore. I'm just blown away.
Well, enjoy the rest of your weekend, and we'll talk soon.
Okay, thanks so much.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Dude, he's so stoked. He's so gassed.
That's
man.
One of our better reactions.
Yeah. We've had great reaction. I'm not against anybody who's not had a reaction. Yeah. Some people don't know how to react. Yeah. You know?
No, the chat is very happy.
Yeah, dude. I'm like, oh, dude.
They're
saying things like,
I already know that the bike is going to a good place. I'm so happy. They're like, I can't help but smile when he's talking.
Well, I was like, dude, he sounds like a cartoon character.
You know what's funny? Larry, who's coming down, his wife called me. She goes, is this true? She was so skeptical
about this.
I'm like, and so finally after we got, you know, like yesterday or 3 days ago when I bought him the ticket, he was like, this is real. I'm coming to get a motorcycle. And his wife, they're both super, super nice people. I can't remember what her name is, but Larry seems like a really great guy also. So looking forward to meeting him. He's actually going to stay in the cabin.
No, I've been loving it, man. So he's been, every time I share something about the raffle, he also shares it.
Does he really?
Instagram?
Okay,
yeah.
Awesome.
I'm the only person who puts a like on it.
Okay.
But he shares it every single time. Awesome. Larry's the man. I'm just like, okay. It's great, dude. Yeah. I love Larry's great, man. He's very cool. Write something. I'll show it to you later. He writes something very heartfelt every time as a
Damn.
Caption. Yeah. So I'll share it in my Instagram stories later so everyone can follow Larry. So there can be more than just me leaving likes on his Instagram pictures.
Awesome.
Because he's a good dude. That was a good
one,
man.
Good.
Yeah. He sounds like a freaking cartoon character. I'm just like, he gave us
like
a
caricature of Tennessee.
Yeah, he gave us a Lord have mercy, dude.
Wow.
He dropped a Lord have mercy.
Lord have mercy.
I'm pretty sure Larry looks like my dad.
Yeah, either like your dad or Foghorn Leghorn. One of the two. Either a giant rooster is going to show up.
Giant black rooster.
They make them in black.
I can say it.
Oh, yeah, you can say black. One, I think everyone's allowed to say black.
Yeah, everyone's
allowed. Yeah, I know. We need some extra debauchery now to reset all the wholesomeness that freaking Morris just dropped on us.
Yeah, we've lost at least half our viewers.
Oh, yeah. People are like, hey, I don't blame people. I don't blame them.
Like, we were at 500. We're at 293 now.
Yeah, I don't blame them. I get it.
So I think we should go do some debaucherous stuff.
Yeah, we're going to go celebrate.
Because that's what everybody else is doing.
Yeah. All right, love you guys. We're coming back to live streams. We're revamping everything, as you can see. We're in a new space. The space is temporary, but we're still going to make the best of it, and then also just make the best of the new space that we go into after this. And I know this sounds like a lie, but we're going to be on time, and we're going to, because we love live streaming. We love hanging out with you guys. It's one of the best ways outside of the campouts that we get to hang out with everybody and interact with the people who support our channel the most. And so we're coming back into that in a I don't know if it's a big way, but basically in the same way that we were doing it before. But I'm pretty excited about it. Shay's getting all this stuff set up. The live streaming is completely all of Shay's stuff because she's the one who knows how all these little doodads work. I don't know how they work at all. So big ups to Shay Lisi on that. We appreciate it. And I don't know. I'm excited about it. I like hanging out with people and just laughing at stuff on the internet. I'm excited.
I like the table.
The table's cool. Yeah,
I like being able to talk, like look at you while I'm talking instead of looking at the screen.
Looking to the side, yeah.
I'm looking at the monitor, like looking at myself. Yeah. It's weird, you know.
Yeah, it makes the conversation.
This makes it so I don't focus looking at myself being like, or her.
Yes. I wish I could have like the chat like right next to the camera. So I had to like look at the camera to look at the chat. That way, like when I'm looking at what they're
usually,
saying or something,
usually
you know?
That's what people do is like they have two screens. Like they'll have two TVs set up on behind the camera.
Uh-huh. Because when I'm talking to you, I want to talk to you. When I'm talking to them,
but
I would
then
like to, like,
they'll have two
the
TVs set up, and one TV is the monitor, like showing what the cameras are seeing, and then the other one is showing like the computer screen, like you know, reacting to TikToks or like.
Oh, okay.
You know,
gotcha,
like.
Gotcha. Well, you're gonna. I'd really kind of tuned out when you're saying all that. I trust you. I think you'll figure it out. I have faith.
It's not.
They both did. Oh God.
No, I said we're still on.
Yeah.
What do I know?
Sometimes I just yap and no one's listening. You know how it feels to yap to somebody who's not listening? Of course you don't. You guys, this fucking channel is like 95% men.
Well, I will tell you, dude, a lot of people say things to me, but I'm just kind of just waiting for my turn to speak. People who've been to the camp out know what I'm talking about.
Okay.
All right. Love
well,
you guys.
Yeah. To end,
you have to get up over there
and
shut it down.
I don't have the like OBS right, connected well, here, to the can, thing. So we actually have to get up and end it. It's not a smooth flow yet, but we'll get there.
What do I say?
Bye.
Stop.